Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Fergal Cahill, and I am the Chair of the Structures and Construction Division, so just want to welcome you all here this afternoon. This is the third time that we've run a half-day lecture series, and what we were finding was that it was difficult to attract people here to evening lectures, so this seems to be a much better format, and thanks for everybody to come out in this wet afternoon. But if you have any, I suppose I'm the chair and Emmett is the vice chair and secretary, and we're always looking for feedback from members of the Structures and Construction Division. So if you have any feedback at all in terms of what we're putting on here or the format, we'd very much like to hear from you. I'm just going to give you a little bit of background to our division, and then I'll kind of introduce the lecture series. But if you don't know, we're one of 32 separate parts of Engineers Ireland. There's 12 regions, 11 divisions, and 9 societies. And I suppose the Structures and Construction Division is most relevant to anybody working in structures. There's 3,500 of us that are affiliated with Structures and Construction. In terms of our age profile, there is about 80% of us are less than 45 years of age. So for some reason, we seem to drop off in the second half of our career. So that's something that we would like to look into and maybe possibly change. In terms of our membership grade, there's about 1,600 of us that are chartered engineers and about 1,300 of us that are ordinary members, so we've got quite a good spread there. But I suppose anybody that is thinking about becoming chartered, we'd encourage you to do that, and anything that we could do to help you along that way, we'd be willing to get involved with that. In terms of our geographical spread, we're mostly Dublin-centric, but we do have quite a good spread throughout the country. But I suppose our gender balance is quite poor, with only 10% female membership. So that's something else that we need to work on. I suppose it's kind of more reflective of engineering in general, but if we could improve that in any way, I suppose we'd like to do that. But at the end of the day, we're your committee, and you know, any feedback that you have, we'd love to hear from you. There's 17 of us on the committee at the moment, and we come from all different types of backgrounds, students, public service, consultants, contractors, and if you'd like to get involved at all, we'd love to hear from you, so just drop myself or Emmett an email. In terms of our programme today, we've got 4 great lectures. We're going to be a bit tight in time at the end, so we are going to try and keep each lecture to 50 minutes, and then maybe have a short Q&A at the end of it. We're going to change the running order a little bit, just some people have to get away. So I think we're going to start off with the Lexicon, and Marcella Murphy is here with us and going to run through that. But I'm just going to call on Emma Davis just to introduce the lecture, and we'll go from there. So,
Virgil. The Lexicon Dunlaoghaire Construction Challenges by Marcella Murphy is our first presentation today. And Marcella has over 25 years of experience in civil engineering works in Ireland and the UK, and this presentation will cover the Lexicon Dunlaoghaire, which is a new central library, represents the biggest single investment by Dunlaoghaire County Council in a civic community. Under the 2004 Dunlaoghaire Rathdown County Development Plan, the central library was envisaged as a crucial element in the regeneration of Dunlaoghaire. Tenor price was 27.5 million, excluding VAT, was financed solely by Dunlaoghaire Rathdown County Council. At its peak, there were 160 men working on site, not including supervisory staff. Lexicon ultimately won a number of national and international awards. The presentation will discuss the challenges of the construction of the Lexicon and how they were overcome. Thanks very much.
Hello, I'm Marcella Murphy. I've got to say to you, Emma, that was my punchline. You've taken my punchline, so I've got to restart it again. I suppose I want to tell you what the Lexicon is first. Some of you will be sitting there saying, what the hell is the Lexicon? The Lexicon is a building. When we were on site, we were calling it the Library and Cultural Centre. I always felt that was a misnomer, because it was so much more than that, and it was certainly so much more to us at Dunlaoghaire. I'll just start off the first ones here. This is the taster. This is what it is. It's a architectural designed building. It was, as Emmett says, part of the 2004-2010 County Development Plan. The County Development Plan, it's not exactly a wish list, it's more a strategy of how we want to move forward. Most things you get in there, the councillors, when they see this type of development plan, they want to know why it didn't happen. So the first stage and a major step forward for Dunlaoghaire was getting this included in the County Development Plan. The plan for the Lexicon was approved in 2006, and following the approval, it went out to a competition. The competition was run by RIAI, and it was judged on not just architecture, it was judged on the economics, the engineering solutions, the construction solutions, and there was one more. So it was quite a balanced judgment. In the end of the day, there were seven. The competition was down to seven, and they had to work up their design. They had to produce a model. They had to do quite extensive drawings for that. The unanimous choice was a group of architects from Cork, a relatively small practice, Carl, Cotter and Nassens. And they produced this winning design, and it is truly stunning. The architect on site was Louise Cotter. She was the engineer's representative. So in the running order on site, there would have been Louise, who would have visited site maybe once a week. She came up from Cork once a week, and I was there with another engineer full time. And that doesn't sound like a lot, and it isn't, and we were kept running the whole time. So that's the finished article. I'll just run through them. Yeah, you might see from that slide how tight the site is. That's probably the one thing. The extent of site is, we're right up against the Royal Marine, we're right up against the metals to the foreground. So if you were standing right in front of the Lexicon, the Dunlaoghaire Harbour would be behind you. There was almost no room for materials. There was almost no room for access. There was certainly no room for an engineer's compound. Our compound was in Mourne Park House. And as Sisk nicely put it, we'll have to do a lot of work to bring this up to standard. This was our protected structure. So that's another view from the back. So I think you can get a better view there. But where you see where the CLGs are, that was the extent of site. There was absolutely no room. The planning on the site was just, it was by the day. Something turned up unexpectedly, it was sent away. There was no parking for the men. As Emmett says, at the peak there was 166 men on site. Sometimes when I wandered around the building, I couldn't see 166 because it was just so big towards the end. But let me just keep on there. There's some of the pictures. I won't talk about that, just the finish first. Let me just go through. That was my line that was robbed. So I won't go through that again. This is the design team, Carl, Cotter and Nassens. They was very small. There was really only maybe three or four of them when the project actually kicked off, and they were working with more detailed design. They took on more, but there was very, very little. The structural engineers were Horgan Lynch. They're also Cork-based. And funny, my boss on site was also Cork-based. I don't know how I managed to get onto the project, because I'm only down the road. Something must have gone wrong there. Arabs were the M&E, DC Wallace were the quantity surveyors, and Atkins came in late at the end of the day, and they were the landscape architects. We're Dunlaoghaire Rathdown County Council, and the tender was won by John Sisk at a tender price of $28 million. That looked like a fairly good price, and it was a good price. I think we knew from the heads up that there was going to be issues on site. I had previously worked with Hegarty's, and they had put in a bid of $35 million, and they spoke to me when this was when the tender price was out in the open, and they said, "You'll find, Marcella, that $35 million is a reasonable cost for this structure." So I said, "Okay, now we've got trouble." So this is one of the reasons why I'll never be an architect or a planner, because when I saw this site, first of all, I thought, "You are joking. There's no way you're going to get a nice building on this." In the foreground, in the background there, you can see the Royal Marine Hotel. In the foreground, it is a bowling green. So before we could do anything, the site had to be cleared. One of the clearance was the bowling green, and that was put down to Eglinton Road. And I also supervised the construction of that. One of the lessons I learned from that is we did a very nice structure for the bowling people in Eglinton Road. and we gave them the keys and headed off. And I had to come back a few weeks later to do some snags, and they had brought all the furniture from the old building into the new building. So I said, right, that's it. In future, if I have any, and I say this to you guys as well, if you're doing any buildings, do the fit out as well, because there's nothing worse than having a lovely, bright, airy building and walking in the door and thinking, what's that smell? From the damp chairs and the plaques on the walls and all the effort that we've gone into in the detail. So that won't happen again anyway. The site was an old quarry. It dates from about the 1880s, and it was to feed the ships in Dunlaoghaire Harbour. And I'm sure it was nothing like this. When the heritage officer asked me as well if I could find the link from this pond to the harbour, and we did find a brick culvert. It had partially collapsed over the years, but we did find the link. What you can't get there is smell-o-vision. It was really awful, really disgusting, and it caused us quite a bit of problems as well throughout construction. What you don't see there are the trees have been removed at this point. You can just see the stumps of them. They were subject, of course, to a survey, and all of the trees had structural defects, and this was brought up at the council meetings. It's not like we can just clear a site and there we go. We have to go through it step by step by step, and the things for the planning of the Lexicon, it was done very well. It was done step by step, and all that, everything was checked and dotted. And we're really glad, because as we look back, this building was just audited recently, and even these things like the survey of the trees was checked. If things like checking the trees, there was a lot of complaints about that, and really, in anything you do in the public realm, it has to be right. You won't get away with anything. I'm not sure you ever really could. As I say, the site was an old quarry, so that means we were on granite. We were on granite rock, and that's good and that's bad. The reservoir that I've just shown you there was the fresh water for the ships, and then the bowling green and the clubhouse had to be removed. That also had to be with the consent of the people from the clubhouse, and that was also by negotiation. And there was extensive trees, very overgrown, and the site is bounded by Moran Park House, which is a protected structure, the Royal Marine, which thinks it's a protected structure, the DART, and the Maritime, which is another protected structure. So it's a challenging site right from the start. The design form is a function of the site. So if you have buildings like the National Museum, the Royal Maritime Hotel, the Royal Marine Hotel, any other buildings there, you have to be sympathetic to that. You won't get through planning otherwise. So the design concept had to be sold to all of these. Now, that's not strictly necessary, but the one thing you don't want to do is, before you spend 30 million, is fall out with your neighbours. So we had to do a lot of work and a lot of explaining, and we had to tweak some bits and pieces. Now, the saving grace is that the design had apartheid planning. So we could always say, oh, we'd love to change that, but it's subject to apartheid planning. So, but the building form did take into account very much its environment and also its Victorian roots, which is something I'll touch on a little bit later. It's lower towards the sea. The site itself is over six, it drops over 6 metres. It's 15 metres ODM at the top, and it drops down to 9 just towards the, as it goes towards the harbour. The proposed building materials are to match those in existence. This was something that Dunlaoghaire itself was very strong with. There's been criticism in the past that the building doesn't match Dunlaoghaire. It doesn't fit in with the granite and the stone, and it's a different design. The design is modern, but it has real elements of the past, like the Dawkey granite. You can see in the pictures that I'll show you again later on. There's the granite. It's not Dawkey granite. There's the brick, which is very prevalent in Dunlaoghaire, and also in older Dublin civic buildings, you'll have a lot of bronze with the heavy patina. That's very typical of a civic building, and that's reflected in the building in the Lexicon. So what is the Lexicon? The Lexicon is, the brief was a central library and cultural centre. So it has the whole gambit of the children's library, the reference library. It has an art gallery, which is a big part of the cultural side of it. Dunlaoghaire didn't have anything like this beforehand. We were one of the few county councils that didn't. So they really wanted a good art gallery. It's a very strong art gallery. We can take very heavy pieces. The walls are designed to take heavy pieces of art. We can take sculptures, which is really quite important. We can attract a different audience now because of that. There's an auditorium, which is about 100 seats, depending on the type of seats. We put in a coffee shop, which also went to tender. It's a concession now to Brambles. There's meeting rooms, and there's 100 car park space. It's an underground car park space. The basement of the building serves as a HQ for DLR Library Service. Rock breaking. The rock breaking. This is where we fell out with everybody right from the beginning. I was central liaison for the site, and there was so much arguments and so much giving out. All the site was monitored from vibration, from noise, from dust, and we never broke the vibration, we never broke the noise limits, and the dust was slightly, and one day it was up. But when somebody or the hotel or anybody rang me up and complained about the noise, I really couldn't say to them, no, I've seen the limits here, and we might have been high there, but we're still strictly within the limits. That really didn't help at all. The only thing that we could, that I really, really enforced on site, was that the time for starting was 8 o'clock, and the time for finishing was, gosh, I think it was 5 o'clock when the noise limit started. Now, when I would try to be on site for about 8 o'clock, but there was times when the contractor and his subcontractor would be starting breaking before that, that absolutely had to stop. Let me just go on to see the pictures of the rock breaking, the green sludge. Do you want to do that one again? I can go forward. Right, this is rock breaking on site. This is when we were really into it. The rock was Dublin granite. It's any of you that have worked with Dublin granite, you know it's a blue type of granite. The excavators and the breakers won't break it by themselves. The breakers will break before the rock will. I had worked previously on the Sandyford Road on a drainage project with very similar rock, and I'd used the CLT, what essentially is a diamond drill into the rock, and a chemical expansive material is put into the rock, a dry type of powder, and this swells, a little bit of water, and it swells, and it breaks the rock, as in it puts cracks into the rock, and that's enough then for the breakers and the excavators to move in and start breaking it. But like I said in the beginning, the rock is good and the rock is bad. Breaking it out was a total nightmare. You can see the boundaries there that we have at the side of the site. That's how sheer, that's how close we were. People were walking behind that boundary. It's good because the foundations were very simple. That was straightforward because there didn't need to be strong foundations because nothing's going to budge that rock. But the problem I had when people would ring and say, "You said we'd be finished." It was almost, because we couldn't clear the whole site, that just wasn't possible. So I was kind of using my crystal ball to say, well, I think it's going to think this long, I think it's going to be that long. So I would think that we'll do some trial holes and we see where the rock is. And I would think, yeah, we're going to be okay there. And then suddenly there was rock, and I'm telling them, oh, you'll be finished in 3 weeks. And I want to ring them up and say, actually, I meant 3 months. And that was quite difficult for the Royal Marine, because they were planning weddings. And they would say, look, I've got a wedding booking taken for 2 years, what can you do? And what I had to do was pay off the contractor and say, look, you're going to have to stop working on site at 4 o'clock. You can't work Saturday, there's a wedding there. You can only work till 12 o'clock. Because it was only fair on them, they're trying to run a business. The Maritime Museum also had problems with access, with all sorts of things. Before we ever started the rock, the other problem we had was clearing the pond, the sludge in the pond. That was supposed to be taken away in sections on the site and dried out, and then just a very minimal amount of sludge would be taken off site. No, but of course that didn't happen. Nothing went to plan. No, that didn't happen. So we had to put lime on the sludge, and it was taken off. Now the lime covered people's cars and people ringing up at the cars. The sludge was contaminated with petrochemicals, so there was another claim on that. But we eventually got rid of the sludge. The sludge, the smell from the sludge and the whole thing was unreal. But also, as I said, not to the past, there was a pond there. So in keeping with going for the future, we very much wanted a water feature to say, right, this is where the old pond was in the past. So there are a lot of connections to the old town and what was there. What else do we have here? I was going around site one day and I said to my friend, Fergal, this is like Star Wars, isn't it? And he said, oh, you've never seen Star Wars, have you? No, I suppose I haven't. But there was very limited access to people on the site. You had to have, REs could have access all over, and there was two of us, and on the rest, almost the rest of the site didn't, because of the chemicals, because of the breaking. One of the things that I had a very hard time with was I wanted to record the rock that was broken out, and I asked the contractor for the figures that he was breaking out, and he wouldn't give it to me. And so I said, how are we going to do it? So what we did was we took the levels of the top of the rock, and we measured down where we finally got the... And it was very difficult to do that with the machines and the breaking, and there were certain areas you just couldn't go to because they had the expansive material in. But in the end, we didn't need those figures. My estimation was about 13 and a half, and the contractor at the end agreed with me. Now, I didn't know why I'd need it, but I wanted... It was too late afterwards. If I didn't have those figures, I would be lost. So at the time, I got it. Here in the foreground, you see, we're starting off with the concrete pours. right, just to say that there was never one approved sample of concrete. They never got approval to start concrete. In the end, they just said, oh, feck it. Can I say feck it? I could say worse. They decided they're just going to start. So we had a sample building right just in the entrance there, over at the far front behind the house there. And... with all sorts of questions on that. Was that the library? It's very small. Is that a birdhouse? But it was actually a sample building, so all different samples of the concrete, of the stone, of the windows, of the EPDM, how that was going to be laid on the rubber membrane around the building. But the early samples of the concrete that the contractor poured of the concrete was not good. It was a mixture of OPC and 50% OPC and 50% GGBS. And that gives a very nice mix at the end of the day. But it is at the end of the day. In the beginning, it looks like nothing. It really looks rough. And the tolerances were very tight with the concrete. I was brought on mainly for the rock and mainly for the concrete. That's how I got landed with this. That's how I got this job. I didn't land it with it. But the concrete tolerances were extremely tight. Now, I thought, having done bridges on motorways, that, oh, concrete, that's fine. We'll throw it up. It'll be grand. No. The tolerances were extreme. They were nothing like I'd dealt with before, and none of the team, and we couldn't even find samples in Ireland that we were completely happy with. So the team went to England, so the contractor, the architect, the client, a load of us went over to Birmingham one day where they were doing similar architectural concrete. And that was really interesting, because that really helped show us what not to do. The contractor over there was very upfront, and he would show us what happened and why this happened. But what also he showed us, which really resonated with me, was the repairs. Repairs on OPC and GGBS concrete are extremely difficult. And the thing is, any builder will rock up and say, oh yeah, I'll repair that for you, Marcella. I said, don't you worry about that. We'll have that sorted out by the end of the week. That's the last thing you want. And I didn't know that only before I went to England and found that out. And it was a really good lesson, and it helped me further on down the line. This picture always gives me the shakes, because I was standing very close to that at about 10 to 5 before this collapse happened. We'd excavated the whole area. Exactly behind that hoarding at the top there, as I say, people were walking. That's how tight the site was. There was no storage. There was no extra room. What happened was the soil nail hit the concrete of the foundation for the wall, the hoarding there, and it didn't penetrate the whole way. I think that might have happened in two occasions. They admitted to one. But it just goes to show you feel very safe. You've got the certificates, and you've got machines, and you've got soil nailing. Oh, it must be fine. It collapsed at around 5 in the morning, and when we came in, we found that it happened. We know from the noise levels what happened, but the Hague Terrace was immediately closed down. There was some, you can see on the far side there was some collapse on that side, but it just a hugely scary thing, and it was reported to the HSA as well as an incident. It didn't happen during the day. That was just the grace of God. I'm just going to the monitoring there on the site. There was monitors all the way through for vibration for breaking out the rock, for noise levels, and for dust. None of them were ever broken. The one of the guys that we had to report to all the time was the DART line, Éireann Ó Éireann. They were very strict on their tolerances, and they would call to site regularly, and they would also look for the vibration monitoring. And because it was rock, the vibration limits were never exceeded, because just the pulse of the breaking doesn't transfer through rock, it absorbs it. A sand or a lighter material, you would have had a lot more problems, and really big problems, because I don't think you would have had this structure on if it was a different material other than rock, because you would have had problems with the monitoring at the Royal Marine and at the Maritime Museum. So because it's rock, we have this type of building. Another type, we probably wouldn't. Again, simple foundations because of the rock. The value engineering was done on the waterproofing. It was Grace Engineering who had proposed a system, and that was accepted on the tender, that was in the tender. SISC came back with their own solution, which is a very good solution, and it worked very well, and that was accepted, and there was a cost benefit to the client. And there was one of the few benefits that the client actually got from value engineering. Let me see where we are now. That's probably a good picture, because it shows you the extent of it and the size of it. It was a serious collapse. Right, the building itself, it's a concrete frame with granite and brick. That's the nod to the Victorian past. The total square area is over 6,500 square metres, so it's a big building. It is when you're trying to inspect things and you're running up and down the stairs and there's no lifts, you really feel the 6,500 square metres. And just when you've finished, somebody rings you to go back up again to the top of the building. We're founded on rock. There was a foul sewer 2.5 metres. Down below the foundations, that was also monitored, and there was no problem with that. Again, with the rock, it was great because nothing was going to touch that rock. It would protect everything. We went into early negotiations with Éireann Ó Éireann regarding the DART line. We kind of saw fairly straight away where the difficulties would be with the protected structure, with Éireann Ó Éireann, with the residents, and we held our hands up early on, and we got into negotiations with them, and they said what they wanted and what they didn't want, particularly the Royal Marine. They were very keen on landscaping and how our building would look in relation to theirs. It was a double-edged sword. It would help their building, but they wanted to make sure that they would be okay at the end of the day, which is fair enough. The chimneys form the central spine of the building, and they contribute to the stability of the building. The building was not stable until the final V-beams were put in at the bottom, these at the top. These 13 number V-beams were holding the roof together. I have some pictures of them later on. They're 40 tons each. They were brought in at night. CISC had to apply for a license from Dunlaoghaire Rathdown County Council to bring those beams in. So the route had to be planned. I'm sure you all know about getting these licenses, getting the beams in. It involves a Garda escort, and I remember one of the things I said to the client, now I don't want this section, as we were approached to Dunlaoghaire, ruined. It was a newly paved section that the architects had put in from Dunlaoghaire maybe a couple of years beforehand, and they said, oh no, won't go near that, Marcella, no. And the next morning there was a big tire track right in the centre of it coming in, and of course they still denied it. But just to lift those beams, it was two 350 cranes used in tandem to place the beams inside. Have I got any pictures of them? Let me see. Yeah, there they are at the top there. They go from larger beams to smaller beams. The idea is that it's the brow of a ship. The early ones were the big ones. They were brought in one at a time. There was a problem because one wall was absolutely straight and the other wall was at an angle. The beams themselves had a fall in them. They weren't exactly central. They had a tendency to tip over. And also there was gusts from the harbour when they were landing them, which there's always gusts for the harbour in Dunlaoghaire. But you can see how white the concrete is, how nicely it was turning out there. But you can also see how small the corbels are that we landed them on. It was a very tight tolerance to get them in. But a fair play to the contractor, who did a really good job with them. There was over 700 drawings, tender drawings on site. With shop drawings, that went over 1,000 drawings. I'm not a structural engineer, I'm a civil engineer, so it was a constant challenge to keep up with what was going on. The architect was a brilliant architect, a really clever, very, very accomplished architect. Her standards were also hugely high. It's because of those high standards that Dunlaoghaire has this fantastic building today. Unfortunately for the contractor, I think he tendered, thinking reasonably, that there'll be some compromises on site and there's some things that we can change, lessen. No, not with this architect. Now, the problem with that is, especially for things like, the real problem came with that when we came to the cladding, the external cladding was stone from Spain. A very tight spec, again, very similar to the concrete, very tight in the type of inclusions, the colour, all of that very extremely tight. And the architect was rejected. We had one panel on the external wall that was a working sample. She rejected nearly all of that. And as we were going along, I think the contractor felt he couldn't talk to the architect, so he decided he would come to me and see could I do anything with him. Now, really, that's not the chain of command, but CISC had come from an environment in Poland where they had lost a lot of money, and I'm sure a lot of you remember that, and they were quite nervous. In the overall scheme of things, this building really wasn't a lot of money, but it affected them and their cash flow, and they really didn't want to lose their shirt on it, so they were quite nervous about everything. So there was very little I could do, so they would tend to ring my boss, and he, very soon afterwards, I got a call saying, whenever CISC did ring them, saying, please sort this out, Marcella. Now, he didn't exactly use those words. They were kind of a different type of words, but I had to sort them out. And it meant the compromise. The contractor should have gone to the architect to sort out stuff. They felt that they couldn't do that, so a lot of the time they were coming to me. The architect was annoyed about that because she felt she was trying to hold the party line and there, here was I eroding it. But it was the client's money, it was the client's time. While I have 110% respect for the architects, we had to finish the building. We had to get something that we could live with. We just couldn't have a stand of. So quite like one of the examples was these beams that are in the foreground here. How's my time doing? The beams in here, the V-beams. I went down to Banagher's to inspect them when they were being cast, and as you can see there still, you can still see the reinforcement inside, you can see the marks of the how they were cast. They're very honest, and I remember Joe Donovan saying at the Taney Bridge in Dundrum, he was very much into favour of an honest bridge, an honest structure. This is the work that the structure is doing, this is how you should it should be reflected, it shouldn't be boxed off. And I felt very much the same when these beams were being installed. And Louise was very unhappy, and she said, no, I want chyme. The chyme is like a tinted kind of moisturizer on them. It kind of makes it look nice and softens the edges. But it's quite expensive. I mean, you've got to get your access to it, and you've got to pay men for it. You've got the time that's going to take. You've got to have inspections. Will that still be acceptable? So I decided, so what I thought was the compromise, that I'd get Banagher on site, provide the access, Banagher would sand all the 13 V-beams down on site, and then everybody'd be happy. No, she still wasn't happy. So I just made the decision at the end that they were going to stay how they were. And anyway, I think she got over it by now, but I'm not really sure. The other thing that I said before was the concrete. The concrete is architectural finish. It looks bad when it's cast at the beginning. It looks worse than OPC for some reason. It dries a little bit differently. It looks just awful. We had David Bennett, who was the client's concrete consultant, and he used to come over from England. We used to call him the expert from England. And he would comment on the concrete and all the rest of it. But he said to me, look, it's going to be a year before this concrete looks well, and they had to be dry out. But I would say now it actually it takes about 3 years for it to go. I was there at the library the other day, and I was up right looking at the walls. I'm sure the librarians were thinking, what's this one like? But it has changed so much. I haven't seen it in a little while. And you'd hardly notice some of the differences. The other thing I took a stand on very much was the repairs. I really felt that a bad repair was 100 times worse than leaving it, and that was completely the right thing to do. I took a bit of a flyer on that because I saw some of the examples that they were using in the back of house. And the problem with the GGBS is that it dries out and it dries out and it dries out. To do a really good repair, you have to, the contractor has to do sample tiles, that they call them, and match up the tiles. So that tile is a mix of mortar, and he will match it to the lightest part of the concrete, and then he will make up that mortar to fix the repair according to that cream. But the concrete has to be as dried out as you can possibly get. But the thing is, when do you do that repair? Like I said, I think it takes about at least 3 years, depending on the heat of the building as well. I mean, I think there's an interesting research project there as well, and the heat of the building and the type of finish you get from concrete. So very limited, very limited repairs. I know sometimes I wouldn't know, is that sample fair face, or is it going to be hidden behind a panel? And I sometimes say, thanks be to the hand of God, that bit is hidden, so I don't have to worry about that bit. There's very, very strict limits. We actually condemned only two. One was horrendously bad, and the contractor was happy enough with that. Another one was near a section of stairs, and there was a standoff about that section of stairs for about a month, but it was just so dreadful. The contractor, he had guys in for the weekend, two of them, doing repairs, and God, it looked worse when it was up for inspection on the Monday morning, and I just said, seriously? And they took it down then later on that day. The cladding was sourced in Spain. The cladding, it's a natural product. There's very strict limits in the specification, but really, it just, I think the cladding was what tipped the contractor over the edge. The stone is cut in huge square chunks, and then it's cut off those chunks. The quarry is huge, nothing like we see in this country. And to do that and to bring it all over and to be then rejected was they were hemorrhaging money on it. So we had to accept a lot more. The compromise I suggested was that we use some of the ones in areas of the building at the roof where only the birds would see, but they were still clad up there. So we did that. Okay, let me rack through this a bit more. Yeah, the external, the building is clad with a rubber membrane to keep the heat in. It's a green energy building. There's a gap then for the insulation, 160, it's two layers of the Kingspan foam. Then there's an air gap, then there's the stone cladding, so it's a very nice, warm, cosy building. The wind cowls on the top there that you'll see again at the end, they suck air out and they also pull air in, at a very efficient system. And then we've aspiration system for a very rapid fire detection. Aspiration constantly sucks the air in rather than just the air and going like that. And works. Heating a green building is provided through a biomass. We've actually three backup boilers of a little thing as well. The heat is distributed through trench heaters, underfloor heating and radiators. Everything is controlled by a BMS, the building management system. The acoustic panels are also fire treated. All of the building is class O finish, and there's 5 million worth of mechanical plant. Now I just touch on that. The arts in the building. The building was subject to the percent for arts scheme. There was 70 entries received. There was a committee set up to choose them. I was put on that committee. I thought it was a mistake when I first got it because I said I don't know anything about art. But they said no, we want somebody who's practical. I think that's a compliment. I'm not really sure. So the winning design was Catherine Lamb, who was this is Christ the King, yeah. This was by the celebrated sculptor Andrew O'Connor. It was originally called the Triple Cross. It shows Christ the King and his three states, desolation, triumph, and consolation. There was a lot of rows about that. When it was eventually commissioned and brought over to Dunleary, the Archbishop Charles McQuaid in 1951 was very offended that he hadn't been part of this choice and this location, and he put a stop to it. Now, I can't imagine this happening in this day and age. It was eventually sited at the end of Hague Terrace. It was in somebody's back garden, in the solicitor's back garden, for 30 years before it was eventually sited here. Brendan Waters, another excellent architect, did the restoration on it, and he did just a fantastic job. The detail is amazing. Archbishop Dermot Ryan didn't want anything to do with it. It's a totally different era. The only thing I think about Christ the King is it's over the car park, so where that is, if you went drilled down below that, you'd be going into the car park entrance. It's not centred over the car park entrance, it's centred over the park area, as you can see it there. Just one word about the facilities management of the building. The building costs, it's a significant amount to run a year. The facilities management is about, it's less than $500,000 a year, so it's a very significant revenue cost. When we were totting up how we would run the building, we were thinking of car park income, income from the studio, income from the concession which Brambles is in, and income from the meeting rooms. Now, they've all worked out really well. The facilities management company has really worked with us to promote all of those. We have a marketing person as well there, and she promotes them via Twitter and Facebook. I think the lesson to be learned is when you hand over the keys, that's not the end of the building. That's probably the beginning of it and the management of it. And when you have a very high spec building like this, you have to be able to pay for it in the future going forward. And that has to be really told to the client. And they have to understand that this is going to be a high cost. The footfall itself, it's very high a day. It's getting higher. People are beginning to know about it. Let me see, I've got the finishing touches here. Yeah, that's the building at the end there, the nine cowls at the top. There's some really great views when you go onto the fifth and sixth floor where the library is. It gives a great view of Dunlaoghaire. Before this was in place, you really couldn't get any good views of Dunlaoghaire. The only one was the canteen in Dunlaoghaire offices, which not fair to the public. But it's we have a link as well for access between the Royal Marine and the Lexicon, and they're very happy about that. There's also lots of brides use the weir for photographs, so it's a bit of a symbiotic relationship. And all the planting, we did a lot of planting here. These trees here, just at the side of it, they were planted at the specification of the Royal Marine. We just felt that we wanted to play nice with everybody. We were Dunlaoghaire Rathdown. We didn't want to fall out with everybody. Although I think I made a good job of most of them. I don't think there's a whole lot of people I forgot. But let me see what else. One of the problems now we have is the cleaning and window cleaning and the building itself, as it's going forward, has thrown up quite a lot of issues. The building to the side here, the Mourne Park House, that's a protected structure. That had to be completely redone because it was showing us up. It was just so bad right beside the nice new shiny Lexicon. There's a concession in there as well. She was in the Powers Court Townhouse Centre. She's now out here as well, the Design Centre. And that also brings, so it's a synergy really between the Brambles and the car park and the West and the pier and Mourne Park House. They all work together to bring people to the library. There was a leak, the repairs, this was in the car park. What every RE wants to see when they walk around after their porridge in the morning is the leak from the pond. The pond leaked quite a bit. There was various reasons. We kept retention on the contractor to get these leaks fixed. But one of the things I do still when I go out there is walk around and check for leaks. But we don't seem to have any problem. That's the pond. That's the weir, the outside space. In about 1900s, two little boys drowned in the reservoir in the on that site, and we have a plaque erected to those as well. So we have tried to keep the community with the past. The families as well were happy with the plaque, and they were part of it, and that's there as well. I think that's it. I'm going backwards now instead of forwards. I think that's about it. Thank you very much.
Great. Thanks very much. It's a fabulous building, so any of you that haven't been there, it's well worth making a trip out to Dunlaoghaire, and I think the beauty really is on the inside. It's a beautiful building on the outside as well, but I think it's a testament to all your hard work. It's a fabulous building. Yeah, did it all yourself, yeah. We just have maybe a couple of minutes for some questions for Marcella, if anyone has them. If you do, just put your hand up and I'll just bring the, if you could just talk into the mic, and just say your name and where you're from and fire away. So if there's any questions, if you just put your hand up.
Bill Harvey, I'm intrigued by the fact that you put so much effort into smashing up granite and then brought some in from Spain.
Yeah.
Could you really not have sawn the stuff on site and used that?
That was one of my suggestions, but there wasn't enough granite, and it just wasn't possible, but that was a suggestion. It would have been great if we could.
Questions, guys? One more.
I don't need the mic.
Okay.
Was there any cost-benefit analysis done of maybe not building the lowest story, which would have made, meant that you wouldn't have to remove all of that granite and the building just to be slightly smaller?
No, it was to get the levels right. Not really. The main thing was to get the site at a place where we could start building and start using. If we're going to do it, we're going to do it properly. 28 million sounds like a lot, but that was, we knew at the time that was a good price. If we were going to get it, we're going to get it done then. And we could. I mean, we did spend a lot of. We had to go into conciliation with the Royal Marine as well. For a number of things. One of them was the extent of site was so close that when we wanted to do soil nailing, like I showed you with the collapse, that had to go through them because we had, even though the boundary was on our side, the soil nails were going into their property. So we had to renegotiate for them as a third party. So, you know, if we're going to do it, we're going to do it properly. And that's, I think, one of the best things about the building at the end of the day. There's nothing mean about it. It is a fantastic, airy, light, amazing story. And everybody that goes into it, people that come there, some don't even come for the library. They come to see the building. And even if they don't know what the building is like, they're just amazed by it. So no, I'm glad we did what we did.
Take one more, if anybody's brave enough.
$28 was almost the tender price. We were up against about $35 for the end. At least. One of the things I didn't mention up there, but what was a big problem was the political environment at the time. It was very negative to the building. There was people criticizing why were Dunlaoghaire spending so much money on this, and about halfway through, we made the decision that we'd have to start building, bringing people into the building, and that was really unheard of. Because I mean, everybody knows on a construction site, it's PPE, it's health and safety. But the publicity was so bad with Pat Kenny, with Vincent Brown, with the Irish Times, with the Independent, with people in the town, that we just felt with 18 months to go we had to do something. So we started to bring people around the building in small groups. Like, this is all I needed with everything else that was going on, giving tours of the building. So we brought journalists in, we brought any sort of groups that we think would be. We brought councillors in, we brought quite a few councillors. We brought small pockets of residents, people that worked on the town in the business area. And we started contacting the journalists and giving them the insight to see the building and see what it was going to be like, and we slowly turned it around. But it was about 4 months of constantly bringing people in. Like, we were like the tour guides there, bringing, like, with our little hands up here, they follow me all the way through the building. But it did work in the end, and it had to be done. And it's just a lesson, I think, in future. I would always take stock of where you are and see that maybe we need to see this isn't quite working out publicity-wise as we thought it would be, and you actually have to take an active role and do something about it, and that's what we did, and it's certainly worth it.
Thanks, Marcella.
Okay, maybe just one last question, just we're tight for time. Yeah, thanks.
Hello, Marcella, thanks for the presentation. It's Tom Dealey, I'm a consultant engineer. But as a very young engineer, I worked for a while with Irish Rail, building the DART, and we decided that we were going to break out granite between Dunlaoghaire and Sandy Cove as well. And the delays were astronomical, and one guy came in as an explosives expert, and he told us that he could clear that up pretty quickly, and it was decided to give it a go. Yeah. So he set up the whole thing. There was massive coverage put on the rocks and stuff to dampen it all down. He tried one. He landed rocks the size of footballs up onto the street. Very quickly, it was decided we are going to take the hit on the delays, and the explosives expert was gone. So I doubt you tried, or did anyone approach you to say we could clear out this pretty quickly with explosives?
I always said no way. I Right.
Yeah. Well.
The explosives, the environment was totally the wrong environment for that. No, and a big green field site, taking the site out of a mountain, fine, not for that site. Mm.
Thanks very much, Marcella. Great presentation. Very interesting. Our next presentation is it's going to be co-presented by Jack Rose and Eunice Hissin of Aecom UK. Jack Rose is a chartered civil engineer from the Institution of Civil Engineers, specialising in the design of bridges. In his short tenure in the industry, he's been fortunate to have worked on major infrastructure projects in the UK and the Middle East. These include the Manchester Metrolink, Ford's Replacement Crossing, also known as the Queen's Ferry Crossing, the Redad Metro, and the Hogarth flyover. All with Aecom, he is currently an MBA candidate at Trinity College Dublin. Eunice Hissin, who will be co-presenting with Jack, is a senior engineer in transportation structures at Aecom, based in Croydon. After graduation, Eunice worked with the building engineer sectors before joining transportation structure team in Aecom. After joining Aecom in 2013, he has worked on a variety of infrastructure design, assessment, and refurbishment schemes. Recent projects include the A406 Neaston Super Scheme, the Tower Bridge Redecking, and Hogarth Flyover. To Jack first. Thanks.
Okay. Oh, good point. Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, all. First, I'd like to say thank you very much to Engineers Ireland for inviting us to come and speak about Hogarth Flyover. It's certainly a great opportunity to stand in front of so many people, so many experts in the industry. It's always quite nerve-wracking because you kind of have to justify why you're standing at the front, right? So it's a great honor. Thank you very much for having us here. So as you can tell, it's a double team that you've got for this presentation. So Eunice is going to jump in to talk about the real bits for the project. So we're going to fly through basically an overview of the project, and what you might notice is that exactly the same themes are coming through from Marcella's project, except instead of a building, you have a bridge. And it's something for, I know, you know, quite a few young people in the audience. Engineering really is about solving problems, and those problems have the same theme. And to be honest, it's usually the context that changes, not necessarily the technical challenge. So as you watch the presentation, that's just something to be aware of, that the themes are very much the same. So that's one of the things I just want to say. The introduction has already been done. And I was just going to say that, I live in Dublin now. I actually no longer work for Aecom, but because this is one of my projects, and we've just published a paper in the Institution of Civil Engineers, the Historical Engineering Heritage Journal. We've just published the paper, so that's why we stood here, really, we're trying to just sort of help with the whole spreading of the knowledge within the industry. So I left Aecom to come and do my MBA here at Trinity College Dublin, and that's why I'm in Dublin. In fact, the reason why I got in touch with Engineers Ireland is that in London, I'm a chartered member of the Institution of Civil Engineers. We have a task force in the IC London region and the southeast to set up a task force to deal with some of the real issues regarding diversity within the engineering profession. And I think it's a bit more stark. I saw the figures you have here. It's really a lot more stark here than it is in London. London is a very diverse place, and we still think we have a problem. And that problem is real. So when I moved over to Dublin, what seems like an eternity ago, but it's actually only 6 months, I tried to reach out to Engineers Ireland to see what work was being done. And it turns out there's fantastic work being done in your institution behind the doors. And next time you see one of those surveys coming to you saying, give us your opinions on women in engineering and LGBT and all the rest of this, please answer that survey, because what we need is data to find out what you guys think. Because at the fundamental basis of these institutions is that we ought to reflect the societies that we serve. And if that isn't so in our institutions, what sort of message are we sending to the wider society? So, I don't know why I started speaking about that, but anyway, so that's why I got involved with Engineers Ireland, and that's why we're here today. Eunice worked with me on this project, and he's turning into a bit of an expert on redecking of historical bridges. And unfortunately, I have to apologize in advance, he's got to catch a flight back to London this evening. So after the presentation, I think he's got to run off. So, you know, especially for a lot of you young guys in the audience, get on LinkedIn and start connecting and sharing ideas. It's all the wonderful stuff that needs to happen in engineering, because engineering isn't quite as fast-paced, I believe, as some of the other sectors out there. So, moving on. The agenda for today is, I'll give you a brief overview on what LOHAC is, the London Highways Alliance contract. I'm sure a lot of you may have heard of it, especially if, if you've been hanging around London recently, over the last 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. A background to the structure itself and the project. And then Eunice will take you through really what was the intelligent part of this project, I believe, the risk management and also the design phase for this project. And then I will sort of pick up with the construction phase and then dealing with, with some final thoughts on the completion of the project. The reason why I got onto the project is I was working on the fourth replacement crossing. We were doing the category three check down in Croydon in South London. And one of my colleagues had to move on to a different company. So then I got put in and essentially I was the project manager to see through the completion of the project. And then after that, I moved on to, can I grab some water? Is that okay? Thank you. And then I then subsequently saw through the completion of the design and the category two check on this one, and then went on to site to see through the technical execution of the project. Thank you. And then any sort of like snag issues, and there are always snags, which to save myself some anyway, I won't cover any of those issues because they would just embarrass me. So that's why I came onto the project. And to be honest, this is the least sexy project I've done, you know, because you work on Manchester Metrolink, fourth replacement crossing, Thames Tideway Tunnels, my last project before I moved to Dublin, Riyadh Metro. Those are all pretty sexy projects because they're big and they're new and they're flash and it's post-tensioning and it's big cables and, you know, it's new metro system. It's so sexy. This is the least sexy, but it has everything that you need to develop yourself as an engineer, and it really helped me get through to the finish line and get chartered. And, you know, for those of you who think that you don't want to be doing, you know, sort of new, old structures rather, and refurbishment, the challenges there are just as hard as new engineering structures, and to a certain extent harder, because you've got to deal with the context around you. Riyadh Metro is a $22 billion project, you know, with 170 kilometers of metro, brand new. You know, what you have to deal with there is a lot less than what you have to deal with the library down in Dunlaoghaire, or the structure that we were dealing with. In fact, I go past the library every day, but I've never noticed it. So I'll have to look out. It's because I'm a bit bleary-eyed in the morning. So anyway, moving on swiftly. So the London Highways Alliance contract, or LOHAC as we call it, there was an initiative between Transport for London and the boroughs of London. So this is a map of Greater London that you can see over there. And the idea was that you would get reliable and efficient services provided to the boroughs of London. Now, there is no requirement for the boroughs to actually take part in LOHAC. It's split up into four geographic regions, the northwest, the south, central, and northeast, east, as you can see in the colouring over there. And you have one framework per region. So Conway Aecom was where Eunice and I came into this. And essentially Aecom, who we work for, it was a contractor because it was a 50-50 joint venture between FM Conway and Aecom. So we took the northwest region, and the frameworks were for 8 years. So it actually runs until 2021, I believe, is the official end date. But it's probably going to carry on because it has been quite successful. And it was all based on NEC contracts. And essentially, a borough would enter into a call of contract if you wanted a piece of work done. So, for example, if you had, if you wanted waterproofing to be done on a culvert or something like that, fairly small projects that need specialist work, you would then enter into a call of contract with one of the framework contractors. So you see four of them over here: CVU, Conway Aecom, Ringway Jacobs. Is it just Jacobs now? Anyway, Ringway Jacobs, Enterprise Michelle. And then they would do the work for you. The call of contract ends, and then that's it, you move on. You can still, you can use them even if you have an existing contract with another contractor, or if you wanted, if your contract ended, you can then pick up all of your work from LoHack. It's an entirely flexible, no obligation type arrangement. But it's proved to be quite successful. The value for us, as it was back then, I suppose, was 50 million pounds. I was going to say dollars, 50 million pounds per year. So it equates obviously to 400 million over the service, the length of the framework. And of course, I don't think anyone would not have noticed the merger between Aecom and URS. So essentially the central region there and the northwest region are all Aecom or Conway Aecom essentially, but mainly Aecom. So that's the London Highways Alliance contract, LoHAC. Just a few details. I wasn't really sure how much detail to put in here, but the ways to procure work. So the boroughs essentially, or generally anywhere in where you have built infrastructure, you have cyclic work that you have to keep doing. And usually, you know, in cities like London, that is all contracted out to someone to do it on a regular basis. And now that work can now be put to LoHAC, and they can do that work for you on a very flexible basis. So you just have call-out contracts for each type of work. And then for some of the bigger things, such as Hogarth flyover, you then have specific contracts to deal with that particular issue, but those are specific items. So other projects in London were, of course, still dealt with by whatever body and whatever contract they wanted. Hogarth flyover was actually quite unique at this stage because it was the only project in all of LoHAC, so in the entire Greater London region, to be procured under this framework. And as we go through this, and Eunice will explain, there's a reason why that was. You know, high reaction time. You don't want to spend ages negotiating a contract or coming up with terms and this and that. You want someone to go in and deal with it very quickly, as I hope you will appreciate. So in terms of payment options, you have, this is all NEC, so I can never remember the options, but you have lump sum, remeasurable, target cost, and on Hogarth flyover, we ended up with target cost. And the reason why we went to that option is TfL wanted cost certainty. And of course, it's great to want cost certainty, but if the situation is uncertain, you're unlikely to get cost certainty. So this was a very mature decision, I think, to go with target cost because that balanced the risk. Okay, so in terms of how the work was actually identified, so the contractor can either go out and identify the issues and then deal with it, and then obviously just bill the client, or the client can identify the issue, do the design work, and then provide it to one of the LoHAC contractors, so which is Conway Aecom, of course, in this case. So for Hogarth flyover, we had the feasibility side. So when we first identified what we had to do, the feasibility design was done on a time charge basis because we were really dealing with a situation that required a lot more work before you could actually get down to the nitty-gritty of what really needs to be done. So we did that on a time charge. And then when we did the detailed design, that was on an ad valorem basis. So that was a percentage of the outturn construction costs as we had predicted at the start. And of course, this is, I put open book there. I mean, it's only open book to a certain extent, but the idea was that we'd have transparency across, you know, the client, the contractor, and in the contractor, of course, there was the design team, which is where Eunice and I came in, and the build team, which is where the Conway guys came in. So we were trying to be as open as we could be with each other. And of course, there was flexibility, and the flexibility is because the whole thing is really, you know, quite flexible, by which I mean you're not obligated to enter into these contracts. So Hogarth flyover, for those of you familiar with London, in West London is Chiswick. This is Chiswick in West London. This is the River Thames over here. And you've got the A4 Great West Road over here. And at this roundabout is Hogarth Roundabout, named after Hogarth, I think he's the reason why we have copyright law and all the rest of it. So. You know, obviously a very famous name and very famous area. And then leading off into London is Hammersmith Flyover, and I hope for the bridge engineers in the room, you would definitely be aware of this project. And if you aren't, please go and look it up, because this is another project that that was a constraint to us, because the repair works. So this was one of the bridges that would have scuppered part of the Olympics in 2012, because at the time there were some cable breaks that were happening. It's an internally post-tensioned structure, and some of the cables essentially were breaking, and the guys in the office, Peter Sparks, who led this, right? Peter. Peter Sparks led a team where they did acoustic monitoring, and essentially you could hear the wires breaking, and that's why they closed the structure. So all the rest of that went on, and now, of course, Ramble are doing the work, but the project is exciting because of how much effort went into preserving this structure. And I think it was actually the first structure of its type. I shouldn't be talking about Hammersmith flyover, I should be talking about Hogarth flyover. So that was a big constraint on the site, because what it meant was that, so there's Hammersmith flyover here, and there's, I've forgotten the other bridge down here now, not Chiswick, the other one that was closed down here. So there were two bridges there, and essentially they both had repairs at the same time. So the diversions were all, a lot of the diversions were coming to Hogarth roundabout. Now, of course, what we needed to do our works was to close off part of the roads leading to Hogarth roundabout. So we essentially had two projects going on. One is actually solving the technical challenges of Hogarth flyover. The other one was actually the logistic challenges of making sure that we're aligned with the works that TfL were doing. And this is all strategic route network. So these are the red routes in London. If you're familiar with sort of how TfL does, you know, idiosyncratically names its strategic routes. So we had to deal a lot with the other projects going around, more, you know, not just looking at the structure that we're dealing with. So yes, very, very interesting context. And this is Hogarth flyover here. It sort of sweeps, you know, we sort of call it the peace bridge without the cables. You know, it does this sort of S sweeping curve over Hogarth roundabout. And when you look at it on, say, you think, how does this thing stand up? You know, it is a very elegant structure. It's 17 spans, 86 precast panels. I think Eunice is going to touch on how we dealt with this. But essentially, so you have A4 leading into central London this way to Hammersmith flyover. I think Eunice has got to cover a lot of this, but essentially, so this is main road is what you need to know. Some very posh houses down here, and I think the Premier League offices are down here. Those sort of people. And then for maybe some people, this is the brewery over here, Fuller's Brewery, with all that famous beer and all the rest of it. So. And this is looking at it, so this is on the approach to the flyover. What we have is, Hogarth flyover is a single lane structure, and when we came onto the project, the speed limit on it was 20 miles per hour. And that was, originally it was 30 miles per hour, same with the roads around it. Then it was reduced to 20 miles per hour because of the condition. It had been deteriorating for a long time. And essentially what they had to do as well was put in these width restrictions here. To 2 meters, to prevent certain vehicles from going over it, and also to reduce, you know, to make sure that people reduce the speed, because, you know, it says officially 20 miles per hour, but if you were there and you see some of these cars flying over this thing, you wouldn't think that they knew that there was, one, a width restriction, and two, a speed restriction. It's quite amazing how just oblivious some people can be to traffic regulations. So that's looking onto the structure as you approach it, and it rises quite dramatically, actually. If we've got time, we've got a little video just to show you just what it feels like to ride over this bridge. Okay, so the actual structure itself, as you can see, it sort of rises quite steeply over Hogarth roundabout. It's 17 spans. It was built in 1971 by Sir Bruce White, Wolf Barry and Partners. I can see why the name disappeared, but I think this ended up as either Hyder or one of the other Arcadis, ended up as Arcadis eventually. So it was built in 1971. It's 250 meters long. In fact, if you go onto the LoHack website, they talk about this structure, and one of the contractor who was working on site, he goes, "Oh, it's only 250 meters." And I was like, only. I mean, how often do you come across a 250 meter long bridge? Anyway, so 250 meters long, 17 spans, and it's not a composite structure, but it uses concrete and steel. So the deck, when we got to it, the deck was essentially bolted onto the steel structure, but it wasn't composite action. It wasn't relying on composite action. It's sort of simple articulation. And then the spans, as you can see here, the spans varied from over the carriageways, over the roundabout carriageways, it was about 18 meters. And then it reduced down to 8 meters on certain sections. And you see that the only position where it's braced longitudinally is right at the center span. So all of the longitudinal loads are carried by the center span here. The reason I love this structure is the simplicity that goes into it. I think you'd be hard pushed to see anyone designing a bridge that looks like this in this day and age, especially in the age of Eurocodes. It looks as though it should not stand up. It does, and we made sure that it will stand up as well. But there's something of a beautiful elegance in this structure. And again, it won't look like Tower Bridge or Fourth Replacement Crossing, but I think that the engineering really shows through in the form here. So it was the rumor is that it was only meant to last for 5 years, and then 40 years later, it was still standing. Albeit, you know, falling apart to the concrete deck. And then also the other thing to bear in mind is it's a strategic asset. It carried 10,500 vehicles. Now, that may not seem a lot, but when we closed the structure, the effect it had on the strategic route network was quite amazing. You know, we used to, on the radio, you get up in the morning on the radio, you hear Hogarth flyover is closed and it's going to cause disruption, you know. Part of me actually feels a certain bit of pride because I'm causing that, but also, you know, it makes you appreciate that what you do in a very specific area has implications way beyond just that geographic region. So this had effects all over London, and especially when we had to close it unexpectedly. And so Hogarth flyover is a type of bridging system called the bridgeway system that was deployed back in the 60s and 70s, I think. It's the only, as far as Eunice and I are aware, we've done our research on this. Hogarth flyover is the last remaining structure, possibly last two remaining structures of its type of this bridgeway system. There were a few built around the UK over roundabouts and all the rest of it. This example here is Bordersley flyover in Birmingham. It was demolished. Again, I say rumor because it literally is rumor. This thing was built in a weekend. So they went onto site and they built it in a weekend. And what I think is great about this picture is the guys in the tweed jackets over here just standing about. You know, it's like a picture of engineering that I kind of miss. Oh, I miss? I was never there. Wish we had, because it seems like such a simple time. But of course, I think we've proven that the safety regulations and regimes that we have are necessary and need to continue being so, because when we did the work on site, we had zero recorded incidents and we lost no time. I cannot think what might have happened there. So anyway, so these are the cousins of Hogarth flyover that unfortunately mostly no longer exist. So when we were arriving on the project here, TfL had already done some inspections, assessments, and all the rest of it, because obviously a bridge does not reach this condition overnight. This develops over many, many years. And so this is just a side shot on what the structure looked like. And you can see these are the precast concrete panels. So the whole thing was built from precast concrete panels set on these steel beams. And you can see there's a great huge crack just running through the panel there. And because the parapets were actually bolted to that, the integrity of the road restraint system was compromised. And on the picture on the right-hand side there, you know, we had great huge slabs of concrete just delaminating away from the panels. And these panels weren't very deep as well, and we were getting up to just under 2 inches worth of delamination, you know, essentially exposing all of the reinforcement, the bottom layer anyway. So an assessment was undertaken in 2013. Actually, another interesting, I think this project was going on around the same time that Marcella's library was going up, a rock was going down. So the weight assessment, the sorry, the live load assessment was 3 tons after 2013, which it had been 3 tons, but it was reconfirmed anyway. So the maintenance regime, I think it's safe to say, had not been successful. Otherwise, we would not be having this situation here or that sort of thing. The concrete repairs that had been proposed were really a little, too little too late, essentially. There wasn't much you can do via concrete repairs. And of course, one of the main things that was at everyone's mind is the safety concerns. If the parapet didn't have a good anchorage, it wasn't a parapet system, it was a curtain. So the client, so TfL, when they came to us, the brief was inspect and assess. So we went out there and we determined the condition. Of course, so someone else had done that work, but we had to go out and do our own work. So when Eunice and the team at the time went out, I think the 3-ton live load was what they started off and was the minimum requirement, because below 3 tons, essentially you're talking about bicycles and motorcycles. So BD74, so this is Highways Agency, Highways England now, standards. So essentially 3 tons wasn't really available. And then moving on from that, there had to be a solution in terms of, okay, we don't have 3-ton live loading, what is available? And I think Eunice is going to talk about the, you're going to talk about the assessment? A little bit about the assessment. Okay, so essentially we then found that, okay, we don't have 3 tons live loading, but the bridge has to remain open, otherwise there's chaos in London. And I don't think I'm even exaggerating a little, you know, it would have been chaos around that part of London. So the first thing to deal with was, of course, you know, the risk and mitigating that risk, and then after that, it's putting in a solution. So I'll hand over to Eunice now to just talk about how we dealt with the risks at that stage, and then he'll go through the some of the design of the solutions that we had as well.
Thanks, Jack. Just before I start talking about the risk management, I will just say, as Jack mentioned there, I'm going to be shooting off straight after this presentation. But if anyone has any questions on anything which I run through or anything to do with Hogarth Flyover, you can find me on LinkedIn, as Jack mentioned. Thank you. So, as Jack mentioned, there was a 2013 assessment done prior to us being involved in the scheme. That found that there was a 3-ton live load capacity. Once we became involved in the scheme, we actually done a reassessment based on its current condition. And as Jack mentioned there, it actually failed the assessment. It would only take a dead load at delaminated areas of the deck. I mean, some of these images here are not quite as bad as some patches where we had the complete bottom reinforcement, you know, exposed along its entire length. And then you could argue that the lower reinforcement is not anchored at all, and your top reinforcement is then working in tension. Instead of compression. So what we done is we immediately realized that a solution is required, and there was an argument that there's possibly some hidden strength in the concrete slab. A lot of research has been done into the contribution of surfacing and what effect that could have on the capacity. We didn't really have time to rely on research and spend a lot of time doing another refined assessment. So straight away we looked to a BD79 based approach, where we commenced monitoring, structural monitoring, and we prepared sort of a red, amber, green, black trigger levels, which I won't spend too long on this, but we basically we had set condition. This is actually for the underside, so this isn't necessarily fully applicable, but starting at the bottom, if you have no spalling or delamination, the panel's fine and you can just monitor it quarterly. But if you have minor spalls, some exposed reinforcement, you move to monthly monitoring, and you start thinking about emergency strengthening. And then if you have more than 20% of the panel area, well then we're saying we should really monitor that weekly at a time where traffic is ideally at a minimum. I was the lucky person to go between 12 at night and 4 in the morning. Didn't enjoy that for 4 months or something like that. And then really in the black, I mean, that's, you need to close the structure now. And TfL were adamant that it would not reach this level. I mean, they were happy to do propping and all sorts of, got an example a bit later on. So those were the trigger levels which we set. And then, as I mentioned there, we were then in the weekly night closures area, and we prepared an EPP, which is, if nobody knows what an EPP is, it's basically an emergency preparedness plan, which sets out what your actions will be if the structure reaches a certain risk level, and who's the person to call on both the contractor side and the client side, all those sort of protocols, diversion routes, as well as your standard methodology for the monitoring inspections. So this was pre-October 2013, what the structure was like when it was handed over to us. And you could see there was a lot of semi-critical areas, which is sort of, you're in the amber sort of zone. So spalling was recorded at about 25 millimetres. You had some rebar debonding over lengths of 1 metre, but it wasn't quite as bad as what we found when we went out after October 2013. We noticed there was a lot of critical areas, so a lot of areas in the red which required more frequent monitoring. Spalling was at 40 mil in some zones, actually more than this. I remember recording one that was at 50 mil, which was, you know, fully, you got rebar fully exposed there. A lot of delaminating concrete, as Jack mentioned earlier, and not in good shape. So that's the critical spans pre-October, and that's what we found during our delamination survey, October 2013. I should mention actually that we only managed to do this full delamination survey because the structure was closed for 2 days in October, where the weather was so bad at that time, they were worried deck panels would go flying into the roundabout. So they actually closed the structure for 2 days. So this is propping of black areas and continued monitoring. Not much to say there. It's just obviously this allowed the structure to continue to be used. At this stage, TfL realised they decided they wanted to fully replace the deck. So early contractor involvement was you know, brought in to develop the construction methodology, identify constraints, timing. And I remember the original programme was 8 weeks to replace the deck. And then TfL come back in another meeting, there was weekly progress meetings, and said, oh, we need to get that 8 weeks down to 7 weeks. And then we thought, oh, that's pretty hard, but we can still do it. Then they come back the next week and said 6 weeks to match the school holiday, so it just made it worse. So once they decided they wanted to replace the deck, this is what we had to deal with. So I'll just, okay. So we had obviously the superstructure, substructure capacity to think about. Obviously that has to be a 3-ton minimum, ideally 7.5 ton to allow maintenance vehicles on the bridge. Then we had these lighting requirements, trees which were managed by the Chiswick Society, yeah. And they're very, really, really precious about their trees. So it was a challenge to actually cut those down. Yeah, you wouldn't believe the things that hold up the project. Pigeons and trees. And then we had, like Jack mentioned earlier, commercial businesses all around residential areas, live carriageways. So a lot of people to satisfy. So stakeholders included Hounslow Council, you know, I mentioned the Chiswick Society. We wanted to keep noise dust to a minimum. We don't want to upset the residents or road users. And lighting requirements, as I mentioned earlier. So obviously demolition was a real struggle because it's a live carriageway underneath, so you have to think about crash decks and all sorts of fun things, site compound and working space. I'll touch on this a bit later on. And then, yeah, as Jack mentioned, it's all over the radio. As soon as there's a problem on Hogarth flyover, it's on the news. So this was there was actually a stage before this, which I haven't included in the slides, but where we looked at could we do patch repairs or could we use a GRP deck instead of a concrete deck. But what we found is that GRP was just too expensive and there's problems with design codes. And then the actual patch repairs was just out of the question once we'd done our delamination survey. So we split it up into four different options. We had this nighttime closure. So that means that you need to then lift in a temporary bridge, allow traffic to run in the day, and then take off the temporary bridge again, and then work in the night. This is really complicated. You need to think about things like parapet anchorage and how you're going to achieve that. It's quite complicated. So the nighttime flyover options, closure options were both quite high because of that. Also the additional risk of you take off a concrete panel one night and then you realize the steelwork underneath is a lot worse than you expected. So you could overrun and then not end up opening the flyover in the morning. So those TFL, didn't. They would have liked it to work, but realistically, I don't think it would have. So then we were onto the full closure options, which was really like for like, which is TM2B, which is all precast deck panels. And then you've got precast deck panels in the areas where you can have a crane quite easily without disrupting the traffic below. And then in the areas where you can't have a crane, you have, which was at the west end, you have an in-situ slab. The option that we selected based on that whole early contractor involvement process was the precast deck panels. So what was the main changes? Although we were doing a like-for-like replacement, we did make some changes, and one of the changes was to change this alignment. So here you can just see a staggered outline of the old deck panels. And that was basically done to achieve this curvature on plan. But it's quite hard to set out. Well, not quite hard, but takes a lot longer to set out, and there's also more design effort required. Whereas we just, we actually found that there was no highways requirement for that. So we could actually just center the precast slabs on the center line of the steel beam below. So we end up with a series of straight spans, which looks a bit funny on plan, but still works. The old deck details, this was an area, the clamping detail was an area of concern. So we had a lot of corrosion to the steel elements, this inverted T section, which you can see there and there, where water was seeping in the joints and then causing that to corrode. So we needed to come up with a more durable way of clamping the precast deck panels down to the steel beam without actually affecting the articulation at all. And this is what we come up with. So we had, just before I touch on that actually, you can also see we've got a parapet plinth on the new deck panel, which allows for an N1 containment parapet to be placed, which was, much better than the existing. And so back onto the clamping details. So we come up with a combination of products, proprietary products, which was a Halfen casting channel. You can see there, cast into to be flush with the soffit of the deck, and also Lindapter rocking clamps. So this was really good because you could place the deck panel on top of the beams, and then you've got tolerance to sort of move these rocking clamps to the desired position, and it's a quick method which would take connections off the critical path. Also, another change was to the drainage. So we had before these gutters at the bottom of there was an in-situ deck over the pier, and these were getting blocked up, pigeons were nesting, and the water was just overflowing onto the steelwork and just causing more of a problem than a solution. So we just simplified the design by having a perforated enviro bridge curb, which just allows the water to run straight through the deck and then down to be taken away. I mentioned early contractor involvement, so this was through that we were able to come up with a clever way of taking off the existing panels without actually damaging the steelwork below by cutting out the clamping points, which is what's shown there. We also had a methodology for breaking out, because the plan was to break this all out using remote controlled breakers. You wouldn't actually have a man up there, or you wouldn't have a machine which is being driven by anyone. It would be purely a remote control operation. Whether this happened on site, I'm sure Jack will speak about, because I'm not too sure how much of this went to plan. Okay. And then crash decks, I won't talk too much about that, but these were the two different types we had. And then I mentioned the zones, so we've got southern approach, which is there. You can see there's nowhere to leave a crane there unless you block up the road, whereas these areas here, the central reserve and northeast verge, you can actually have a crane in that grass area and not affect the roundabout below. New panel installation, that's just showing you. So there's the precast panels. There was an in-situ stitch over the piers. And also noise and air quality monitoring. This shows our actual points, proposed monitoring points. I think they did use that in the end, did they? Lighting. We made a lot of energy savings from the lighting, because the lighting team carried out a study which showed that there was enough light coming from the roundabout below to need new lighting on the bridge. So that's a massive energy saving per year. So the idea was we just install new lighting on the slip road, which joins onto the A4, just to allow your eyes to adapt, and you don't need it over the bridge. Right, I'll quickly pass over to Jack, because I'm worried we've got short time.
Thanks, I'll leave that here for you. Thank you. Okay, so I'll just, I'm going to throw loads of pictures at you now, basically. So after Eunice and the team had done the design and we'd had it approved with TFL, which was no easy process, I should just say. The construction itself was, as I said, done under an NEC contract, and all this good stuff about lump sum and target costs, but that wasn't really the interesting part. So when we went onto site, so I was site engineer as well for this. Essentially, I was the only engineer on site to oversee the technical execution. What we started with is getting those crane mats in place. So the flyover, you can still see the vehicles over there. The flyover had to remain open until the very last second. So we started with the things that we could do. So the trees were cut, some tiers were shed, and then the crane mats went in. And then in the meantime as well, the precast panels were being constructed. These were being constructed in the Midlands somewhere. And we used just-in-time system because, as you could see from the images, there was literally no space on site to put 86 panels. So essentially, they had to arrive as and when we needed them.
So this is one of the engineers from TfL. She worked on the design as well. So we had interesting conversations afterwards. So these are some pictures of the demolition. So these are the breakers. Over the roundabout, we used the smaller Brock breakers because there was just a little bit more risk there. So we didn't want to cause anything to collapse unexpectedly. But further towards the ends where there was less risk with traffic, we used the slightly larger ones. And one of the really impressive things about this project, I have to say, was how we dealt with the waste. FM Conway, one of the reasons why they won this contract was their recycling capabilities. So all of this concrete and the separated material, it went to their recycling plant not too far from here, in fact, to be reused elsewhere. So I thought that was a good environmental bit. And once we demolished the deck, we had the naked concrete. So this is what it looked like over here. And my job was essentially to look through 250 meters of this viaduct, this flyover, and check each element, each critical element. I needed a whole notebook to take down all the details, and then assess each bit, what needs to be taken out, what needs to be left in, what needs to be cut out, what needs to be repaired. Some of the demolition guys, I don't know why they think that their job is the only job that needs to be done, but they go in all gung-ho and just breaking things. So I had to do a couple of repairs to the main beams, so with like some quick calculations on site. That was good work. And then the painting as well, we had to repaint this thing, but of course, painting is several layers, takes time. So what we decided to do is we'll paint the bits that need to be painted, or rather that won't be accessible once the panels are in. So that's why here you see that only part of it is painted. And then we got onto the exciting phase, which was landing in the precast panels. One of the interesting bits is that, you know, the weight of these panels are so sensitive. 7 tons was the weight. Essentially, if it went to 7.2 tons, the crane couldn't lift it. And one day, a truckload of panels arrived, and the lifting guy said that they couldn't lift them because it was 0.1 of a ton over. And I said, well, that's impossible because my certificate says it is 7 tons. So we got to an impasse, and I said, I told them is take these panels to a weighing bridge, which was a few miles down the road, weigh the panels, come back, tell me what they are. And if they are 7 tons, lift them. So then they had no choice but to lift them. So that was a tricky problem. I then had to do a dry run of the precast installation, the installation of these panels. And one of the interesting things, of course, is the deck, you'd had a lot of onto the steel beams. When we took the panels off, of course, the beams hogged because the load had been relieved. So what I found then, so when I landed the first panel, this is me pretending to be technical. When I landed the first panel, it was rocking around the center. So what I was expecting is they would just sit lovely, you know, onto the beams, and then that's it, I'd bolt it. But it didn't, it rocked. So, OS moment type thing. You're an engineer, so you figure out a solution. And essentially it was to just adjust the packing underneath the precast panels. And of course, once you have all the precast panels back on, the weight of it will mean that the steel beams return to their original shape. And even though the mortar is dry, the rubber strips below it will allow some of the movement, some of the longitudinal movement to occur. So you won't get cracking in your mortar. And it was epoxy resin mortar that I used on this particular thing. And that really mirrored the original solution as well. So we weren't going too far off. And this is how we clamped the precast panels to the deck. Very simple solution, very elegant in my view. We had great difficulty convincing TfL that this was okay, and I had to throw case study after case study at them to convince them, and eventually they were overwhelmed with that. So this is just some detail of the in-situ stitch. So you got your precast panel landed either side, and then afterwards you just you pour in the last section. Following that was the waterproofing. So this is Sterling Lloyd's lovely waterproofing material, so sprayed. One of the really curious things as well that someone kept reminding me of was that, of course, we've got a new parapet here and a new deck. What about on the abutments? That we didn't replace the abutments. It was old concrete. And so essentially, I had a guy on site do some pull-out tests in the abutments to make sure that the load under impact loads would be carried by the anchorage. So it was a mix of this and that, but at the end of the day, it was practical engineering, and this was a good thing about this. Eunice was talking about the straight spans that we had there. Of course, you can't have zigzags in a road because that's just not conducive to safe driving. But we used asphalt curbs here. That saved us, one, a lot of time, and two, gave us a lot of flexibility. Because with the asphalt curve, we were able to create the environment that you needed so that when you were driving along, what guided you wasn't the zigzag of the deck, but the smooth curves of the asphalt curb. And this was the drainage unit that Eunice was talking about. It just allows water to seep through. And then we had TfL come in and with their notepads and judge us, and they said we were okay. So with 10 hours to go, we opened on time. And I keep talking about 10 hours because it's such a huge achievement. 10 hours is a huge achievement if the opposite of that is months or weeks, you know, out. And so to give you some context, you know, we started with a structure that was 40 years old, falling apart. In 12 days, we had stripped it of its deck. In 22 days, we were landing the new panels. In 31 days, the parapet system was going up. For those of you with keen eyes, yes, that doesn't line up. And then in 42 days, we had reopened. And that, for me, was a personal milestone. And here we are with the entire project team, well, entire representatives of the project team. And the first car off the bridge was a classic car. And it was quite appropriate because one of the neighbors on the site was a classic car salesman with cars that none of us could afford, I'm pretty sure. But yes, and this is what the structure looks like today. Still looks scary because I still think, how does that stand up? But also, it's there for a good while now. And you know, the just to give you an idea of the project profile, we opened on day X 42. 5 days later, the NEC published their bit on us, saying we'd finished it. Great, thank you. No mention of the design team. Only TfL. You think they did all the work? So it was a very high profile project. If I just get a couple more minutes, is that okay? There is a drive through video. It is more than a couple of minutes, but maybe we might go through it. So just some final thoughts. Bill's here, actually. I had to chase him up for some work. But and the reason I have this Syria guide up here is no matter what you think about the condition of the structure, 40 years is 40 years. It's a huge achievement if the original intention was 5 years. And whether it was a failure of maintenance or a success in design, that structure got to where it is, by crook or by hook. But the lesson there is that certain things get you to where you are. And if you don't inspect things properly and you don't deal with hidden defects, you will run into problems. So there's a new Syria guide that we worked on almost as soon as we finished there. And I was chasing Bill up for some details because obviously he's an expert in masonry structures. And ourselves and Arup worked on this. So it's a whole rake of advice on how to deal with steel bridges, timber bridges, which was my favorite section, precast, all the rest of it. So if you do get a chance, please browse through it. It has some very practical advice, and it's been published this year, I believe. And all that remains for me to say is thank you very much for your attention, and I hope that was interesting. Yeah, it's literally. Okay, we've got a couple of minutes, so just to give you a feel of what it looks like. So this is the end. So this is driving over. Oh, there's music playing. Okay, maybe I'll just leave it. I gave this presentation to the London Bridge Engineering Group, and afterwards I thought there couldn't be a more inappropriate choice of music to go with that, and I forgot to take it off for this thing today. Maybe next time I'll remember that Kanye West isn't the appropriate music. well, yeah, I think at one stage I had someone else anyway. But that's what it feels like. And I think to date, it's one of my proudest achievements. So thank you very much for your time.
Okay, thanks very much, guys. It was a really enlightening presentation and makes me really want to go to London and check it out. So, we just have a couple of minutes before we have a coffee break. So if there's any questions for either of the guys, if you could just put your hand up and I'll just bring you the microphone so you can speak into it. So if you just say your name. And
Eamon Stack, Benaher Precast. What's the design life of the new slabs?
Okay, initially it was meant to be 10-year design life for the structure. But of course with specification codes, 50 years is really the minimum.
Yeah.
But overall we ended at 30 years as the target design life for the new precast panels.
Yeah. The deck looks only about 150 thick, is that right?
175.
175, yes.
Yeah, what size bars and cover do you have?
What cover?
Yeah, the size bars and cover.
We were pretty lean on the cover. I think we were down to 25 mil in some sections. Because we use GGBS as well, a very high percentage of GGBS, which for the precast panels, it wasn't too bad. But because of the concrete quality, we were able to be very lean on the cover.
What was it, C45, 55, something like that?
No, we were top of that. I think we were 55. We were at the top 65. End. Yeah, it was top end.
Yeah, and the original structure, how much cover did it have?
It had similar amounts of cover.
And was it carbonation or salt that would have caused?
We did some tests on it, and the previous guys who were on the project did it as well. It was chloride essentially.
Yeah, road salt.
But it was a combination, though, because of the carriageway, there was carbonation-induced corrosion as well. So it's kind of a combination of two. Once you start losing your cover to your rebar, you get the carbonation problem as well.
Yeah. The length of the panels was 87, but they seem to be about 5 meters long, is it? Or some of them?
There were 87 panels.
They varied.
There were 1.8 meters long was the standard one. And then the width was 3.6?
About 4.5, I'd say.
3.8 meters. In fact, one of the really, I say funny, it's not actually funny at the time, is we were landing all the panels and we were coming in from four directions. So two that way and then from the middle out that way. And then in the center, the gap was too small. So it was one of those, oh heck moments. So one of the good things as well of this project, which we didn't intend obviously, but it meant that I had to call up the precast fabricator and ask them to make one of the panels shorter. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been able to close the thing off. So, that was just a side note.
Thanks very much.
One of the things I'll say, you might think 30 years is a weird design life, but it's because Transport for London actually have a bigger plan for that junction in 30 years' time. So that's 30 years will say minimum. Marine structures are up to 30 years.
Yeah.
Okay, does anyone else have another question? You just put your hand up.
I just thought I'd show this picture. We're all concerned about safety and the speed I was talking about, but it does happen. This is someone who clearly hadn't read the sign and tipped over. 20 miles per hour, you shouldn't do that with your vehicle. And then, so this is before the structure, our project. Afterwards, literally months afterwards, this truck plowed straight through the width restriction. There's the barrier, and there was a sort of an eyebrow wiping moment for me. My parapets there are still standing, and the anchorage is still good, and it contained the vehicle, obviously. But what I find remarkable is, at which point did he realize that he ought to have stopped? Because there's the width restriction, and he's there on the bridge. Between there and there, I've forgotten what the distance is, but it's enough of a distance for you to realize that you've gone the wrong way, right? These things do happen in real life, and it's not just a theoretical situation in a design code.
Okay.
It seems to be the case, it's pretty clearly the case, that the only width barrier that is worth having is one which will physically prevent the vehicle from going through. I realize that's going to be pretty solid, but it is possible. You need a concrete block there.
Yes, and one of the other things that TFO wanted to do was, as well, Here it was virtually impossible to put a physical barrier to stop vehicles going through because you've got two carriages either side of it, not a lot of space. But they wanted to put in a way in motion type thing as well to detect the weight of the vehicles as going. But as illustrated here, not everyone would stop even if they are overweight. You know, this guy hit barriers and he still made it onto the bridge. So I think even in a normal situation, I think you'd be hopeful for that. But you're right, Bill, that only an actual physical barrier would work here.
What is the restriction? Is it cars only, or is it up to 3.5 tons at the moment?
Three ton limit.
Okay.
The design was for 7 tons, as Eunice was saying, in order to allow maintenance vehicles to go over. And in construction as well, we had slightly heavier vehicles, of course, to allow the construction works.
Okay, and there's no collision beam. Obviously, you're not going to collide into something, but something just to prevent over-height vehicles, which obviously would be heavier.
No.
Yeah,
no,
nothing like that.
No.
Okay.
And as I was saying, the context again here, there wasn't really scope to do that. And what we were up against here was really the time aspect. 6 weeks was all we had, and we had to finish within 6 weeks, because then the schools open up and the traffic volume just suddenly balloons. So all of those things were things that would add time and would take us beyond our window. Yeah.
Okay, we might have time for one more, but then we're going to just take a 15-minute coffee break and try and get back here for 4:05. Okay.
I'm just wondering, on your deck, how did you deal with expansion, contraction? Is there any joints?
There are joints. So we have, every panel has a movement joint in there, and it's the design was for 10 millimeters, and we had some negotiation to go through with TfL to actually arrive at a dimension. But essentially, all of the movement, so you don't have 250 meters worth of early thermal expansion, for example, to be dealt with at the abutments. It's all dealt with at every panel, so you have very nominal movements, essentially, between the panels.
Okay, thanks very much, guys. I think we had two really good lectures there in the first half. If you could just show your appreciation in the usual manner, right?
Very much, everyone, for coming back so promptly, and we'll start our third presentation, which is ElevArch, a revolutionary new technique for vertically jacking masonry arch bridges, presented by Dr. Bill Harvey. Bill Harvey is a world expert on masonry arch and tunnel behavior, and author of the ArchEM software package that many of you will be familiar with for analysis of masonry arch bridges. Bill was determined to become a bridge engineer at age 7 when his uncle took him to see the Clifton Suspension Bridge. That lifted someone who had a bare pass at 11 years of age and took him through to Leeds University and on to a PhD, followed by work on the Humber Bridge. In 1977, he moved to Dundee as a lecturer and worked in universities until the year 2000, when he set up a consultancy working on masonry arch bridges. Where he set up a consultant working as a masonry arch bridges. In 2006, he joined the Flint and Neil team, looking after the Humber Bridge, contributing to work on the towers and vaults. As Noel Cord once said, work is so much more fun than fun. Thanks, Bill.
Okay. I want to start with a slight distraction and say I'm standing here looking like Dilbert because I noticed there's a few young engineers in the place. When I went to work on the Humber Bridge, I bought myself a pocket camera and carried it in my donkey jacket pocket, as you did in those days. And as a result, I have 2,500 slides of the construction of the Humber Bridge, which are worth a fortune. Yeah? Buy yourselves a camera, fasten it to your belt, put it on when you get dressed in the morning, take it off when you get undressed at night. You will never, ever regret having a decent camera in your pocket. This one has a 720mm zoom, which means that I can picture just a number on that clock at the back in full frame and do that handheld. It will also work with my phone as a viewfinder, and I can put it on a pole and stick it up somewhere where I can't otherwise see, as I did just last week in Manchester when I wanted to see a bridge over a fence. Stuck it up on a pole over the fence and took a picture. Enough. Email address at the bottom. There may be questions. Do email. There was talk of hidden defects earlier. My son, who did a talk on that a couple of weeks ago, wrote some really quite good notes on it, and they are available. but you'll need to email me to ask me where to find them. Onwards. Where do I start? 27th of October, 3 days before I flew to New Zealand for my holiday, I woke up excited, not about going to New Zealand, but because we'd actually lifted the bridge and I was starting to think about how to do it better and cheaper, but also about the fact that I got an x-ray of an arch bridge. Yeah, we'd cut through it with a piece of wire and we could actually see what's inside. And when you look at it, you think, what? Just bricks laid out like soldiers with no mortar in between them? Yeah, that's the way they did it. As well to remember that. And these days you can take a whole load of snaps with a camera and piece them together and produce a model of the whole thing, which shows you that the back face of the abutment isn't parallel to the front face. So if you've set out the jack position going at right angles to the back face, you get it in the wrong place. Always a good idea to think seriously about what you're doing. So what's all this about? The pantographs hit the bridges, the power lines get too close and you get arcing across, the bridges have to be either taken out of the way or moved upwards, or you have to dig the track down. Digging the track down makes it wet underground. Reconstructing the bridge is kind of expensive and time consuming. Lowering the track, as I say, produces problems, and it's also expensive because you have to lower the track for a long distance. You want to go down half a metre, you've got to go back 300 metres each side. Take out the whole track and dig it down. It's a serious, serious business. And I'm sorry, there isn't a video, so we'll skip over that. Those are the alternatives. And it highlights show the model, but I got to the airport this morning in the car and felt my bag and thought, they're not going to let me on with that. I'm going to have to tip the model out. So I tipped out the model. However, I first started pursuing this idea nearly 10 years ago. Nobody wanted to know. Next thing I heard, there was a competition to avoid demolishing arch bridges. I said, but guys, you know, I just say 10 years ago, and I've been saying, anyway, we met Fresnay at the inaugural meeting, played with a little model, Fresnay got on board, and then we got a bit of weight behind the system. And RSSB were prepared to fund it and give us a trial. So the business is you've got to contain the thrust, otherwise it's no longer a structure. And if you do that, then you can pick it up. And everybody says, but they're brittle structures. No, they're not. They really aren't brittle structures. They don't fall down unless you really want them to fall down. And even if you want them to fall down, if you don't do it the right way, it can be quite hard to get them onto the deck. Contain the structure, cut it free, lift it up. That's really all there is to it. It becomes a bit more complex as you go. We had a 9-month desk study with all the people involved, getting involved, temporary works designers, permanent works designers, my own design work on where the masonry goes and all the rest of it. And we were given a sample bridge to work that through on. And then at the last minute, they decided actually that was over a live railway and perhaps we'd try it on a dead railway first time. So when we got into phase two, we had to start all over again. So we did get to a demonstration project. There were still people who said it can't be done, still people who were determined it was going to fall down as we went. Moco Farm, believe it or not, if you ask Google Maps to find Moco Farm, it will pull it straight up. There is the bridge to look at. What does it look like? This is what it looked like when we first went to the site. Perfectly happy, long neglected accommodation bridge for a farmer over a railway. Slightly strangely, 33-foot span. Why? I'd never come across a railway bridge with more than a 30-foot span before. 33. And apparently they all are on this line. Circular arc. You can see, I think, a line there and there where the appearance of the wall changes, which is a sure indication that something's going on behind. That might be useful later. You can also see that, like most of the bridges, most of the brick bridges on Network Rail, it's been reskinned. It's the cure to everything. Reskin it. I never miss the opportunity to say, you mean papering over the cracks? Yeah? You cut off the only part of the structure that's properly built and that's carrying all the load, and you rebuild it without attaching it to the structure and without stressing it, and you think you've improved things. Not true. There's a nice little crack, I hope it's visible to you, down here. Yeah? Bear that in mind as we go forward. But you can also see in the other picture, you could get your fingers behind that skin. There's nothing holding it on. Where it's not been reskinned, there's the usual pattern of bricks in good quality and bad quality. Again, a very clear line somewhere about here. It's the same line as we were looking at before, but notice the bricks below are in good condition, the bricks above are in bad condition. That's because somewhere around that point, the wall gets thicker and the bricks are protected from the damp just by the thickness of the wall behind. Notice also that they seem to not believe in gravity in the old days, did they? Notice how the parapet just nudges out 40 millimetres? It looks nice, but it slightly reduces the stabilising moment that's available to you. Here's a look underneath. Fairly typical in that you've got a nice black line and no mortar where the steam used to hit the bridge. That's just another picture of the cracks. Really rather strangely, these are diagonally opposite corners. They both have a crack. There isn't a crack in the other corner. And if you go to the next bridge and the next bridge down the line, they have cracks in diagonally opposite corners as well. So there's a little thing to tease one about for occasions. It's a fairly narrow bridge, which kept the costs manageable. It's not been very much cared for. The farmer bounces heavy tractors over it fairly often and clips the wall and then blames the railway for having the wall in the wrong place. Another comment about pictures, that's a single frame. Things you can do these days. That's a 14mm lens on a full frame 35mm camera, and that whole thing is in one frame and you can zoom in and see the details. We even have a drawing. Of course, it's a lie, or at least it's not the whole truth. But it's kind of handy, isn't it, to give you a little bit of confidence that you know what's there. You can see now what I'm saying about the walls at the sides changing thickness. We'll look a little bit more detailed. Interesting features of railway bridges. Fairly typically, this is the existing ground level. The foundations are always below existing ground level, but not necessarily far below. Obviously, the abutment has to be founded below the formation level for the railway, but not very far below there either. But you wouldn't try and build a wing wall sitting up here. If that was built in a cutting, the foundations would step down here. And there's a section through which says that, well, it's a bit disguising, isn't it? Of course, the drawings have been microfilmed and then turned into a PDF from the microfilm, so you lose a bit of quality each time and you can't really read the numbers and you can't really see the lines. But it suggests that there's a line there where the spandrel wall gets thicker and then lines there where it gets thinner in the other direction. And we can see we've got backing in the arch here, which is pretty much to the level of the crown, as more or less usual, and back to the rear face of the abutment. If the bridge was wider, there would probably be a counterfort in there. Here's a section looking the other way, one section through the centre of the arch, one section showing how the parapets tilt over the edge and how the spandrel wall is constant thickness through most of the height. It's a lie, but never mind. And also in the bottom right-hand corner, handwritten on the drawing, because that's the way they did the tenders in those days, is the pricing from the contractor with a final price of £790, 12 shillings and sixpence. And you would have fun building a bridge for that these days, wouldn't you? Something else you can do these days. There's about 1,000 photographs in there. being able to do. Something that we need to think about. Yeah. There is no longer any excuse for not having a decent record of these old bridges. There's about an hour of photography. It did take the computer half a night to produce the model, but you just throw the photographs at the computer and it produces a model, and you can look, and you can see here the model. Right, so it's not perfect, but it's pretty good for something to try out on. How are we going to do it? Well, the original plan was chord holes, chord slots here with vertical bearings. There was some sort of two vertical bearings at one stage to take the thrust out of the arch. Holes under here to take jacks. A cut and a cut to release it, and up it goes. And of course, sorry, these were somebody else's slides that I just picked up, but working the way through, you've got to gather the thrust. We pick it up into two components, the vertical and the horizontal. Once you've done that, if the bridge is free to rotate about those supports, then you've fixed where the thrust is. It puts the thrust where you ask it. You've still got one redundancy in the middle. Yeah? So there's still spare capacity, because provided you keep the thrust somewhere near the middle at the top, it's going to be fine. And then we go through the process. It was deemed necessary to protect the parapets against falling off, not particularly because we thought they would fall off, but there were going to be people working underneath them a long way down, and we were going to be rattling them, so things in there to hold them together. Because of the cracks, we thought we'd better put a saddle over the top and just over the very crown. And that was there also because we were going to be taking the road level down and we weren't going to get much distribution, so we thought we'd get a concrete deck in under the farmer's vehicle. A saddle over the top of the backing as well, because we put in a load of reinforcement, which I think we're all reasonably happy now was unnecessary. But fence the place off, cut the bridge out, jack it up, fill with drums full of mortar bags, and hold it all in place, and then make good when we've finished. The jacking system was one that was newly produced by Enerpac, and because of the loads we were working with, it wasn't designed to be used like this. It was designed to push from the top of the jack. We pushed from the plate at the bottom, lifted it from the bottom. So we were effectively pulling that plate up with the ram, but there was plenty of capacity to do that. And it meant we could produce support over quite a large area as we went up. This thing pushes the ram down in the middle, gives you 120 millimeters of clearance. You put in a square of ecchi timber each side, take the weight on that, retract the ram, put some ecchi in the middle, and jack away again. So you go up in 120 millimeter steps, and it's fairly efficient and straightforward. We did a load test before we started to see how it behaved, and unfortunately that's got a bit grey, but we could actually see the deflection under that tractor, and you can see the front axle and then the axle under the trailer, which is rather bigger. Deflection about 0.6 or 7 of a millimetre, not really a lot. Here's the site started. A road put in for the farmer because he still had to get around his site, and gates for us to go through in the other direction. We start to clear off the bridge and you start to see just how true the story is inside, and we find that the spandrel walls actually don't step out to their full thickness at that height. They step out to about two-thirds of it and then step again when you get down to the top of the backing. I wonder whether the contractor was just being a little bit mean with the engineer. That doesn't happen, does it? Not in the real world. Drilling in vertical reinforcement because we knew that the abutment was a mess. Digging out behind, because the idea of this is that we don't invade the track in the long term for this particular
job, we did invade the track a lot, not least to put in a load of monitoring equipment. But because we were trying not to invade the crack, we worked from behind. Notice, I think you can probably see it, I certainly can, the crack here, which is rather more than that millimetre that was showing in the skin that they papered over the crack with. Yeah. Now, whether the crack is actually wide enough to put your hand in just behind the skin, we don't really know, but it does seem possible. There we are, look a bit closer. You can see why we felt the need to put a little bit of reinforcement in there to hold it together. On the left-hand side there, you see the core holes for the bearing to go in. And here's the final step out to the full width of the spandrel wall. Perfectly satisfactory from an engineering point of view, but not what's shown on the drawing. And there's a core coming out, which was the first indication we got of what the quality was inside the abutment. And bear in mind that at this stage, the abutments had been grouted fairly heavily. And what they found was that the grout doesn't find its way through into the voids because they aren't interlinked. So what the guys did, typically, and let's be right, what the Roman masons did when they were building bridges like this, typically, is that when there's no one around, they quickly spread some mortar over that layer of bricks, bang, 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 fill up the layer and spread some mortar over the top so you can't see the fact that we've not bothered filling the perpend joints and all the rest of it. And by the way, probably we put all the bricks in frog down, which makes it a lot easier and a lot faster and halves the strength, little things like that. Stitch drill up the side to take the bearing, and there on the right hand side is the bearing in place. It's simply a sheet of steel, a pad of steel to slide with a little piece of PTFE in the gap. So there's a strip of the right hand part of that bearing. Can I see? Yeah, this bit here has a piece of PTFE this high in the middle. So we are actually concentrating the load there, but the plate is to spread the stress a bit on that really quite weak brickwork. And again, as you look up that slot, you can see all the empty joints in the brickwork. After a little bit of thought, we decided it would probably be a good idea to incline the vertical cut slightly, so that we were confident that it came clean rather than sticking halfway up. A bit of paving in the back of the bridge and a hole through to let the water out. A T-slot cord for the bearings, for the jacks, and the jacks slotted into place. And again, another view of the bits of reinforcement holding the thing across its width to make sure it didn't break its back as we lifted. Then across the span, we put some carbon fiber window cleaners poles with a potentiometer at the end to measure change of span. Now, the carbon fiber is subject to expansion, but we were actually able over the period of a week or so to measure, to relate that expansion to temperature and calculate it out, and therefore have a decent plot of what was happening to the bridge as all the excavation went on and stuff like that. The little box on the back, oops, sorry, wrong button. The little box here on the back of the abutment contains the logger, which was designed and built by Hamish, actually, for field logging of live loads. It was designed to measure at 100 times a second on all the measurements. We didn't need that, so it had to be reprogrammed quite severely. And the aluminium frames are just to try and provide a bit of wind bracing for those poles. We did think at one stage of using wires, but there was no chance of holding them still. And there's the bridge halfway up. No, it's slightly more than halfway up. What is there? 720 millimetres up. And no sign of any distress at all. By this time, people were beginning to smile. There'd been, you know, a few slightly worried faces until we got to here, but by this time people were beginning to think, this actually works, doesn't it? And it's really quite easy. I just push this button and it goes up. and I let go, we put in some wood, and I push this button and it goes down onto the wood, and I push this button, and it really was as easy as that. Absolutely silent, of course. PTFE is good like that. We tried to measure a whole lot of things as we went. One of them was transverse movement.
The only place we could conveniently do that was on the side of the bearings. And we built this little rig, which is held on by magnets, which isn't ideal, but then there wasn't a lot of space or a lot of time. So the frame fits in here. There's a magnet hooked over the top to hold it vertically, a magnet there and there, and then a backstay to stabilize it. And just here is a potentiometer bearing on a strip of aluminium fastened on the edge of the thing, so it can slide up and down and measure lateral movement. We've already got gauges measuring changes of span, and we also have a gauge measuring how far up we've gone. A week before the job, somebody said it'd be really nice if we could show the public what's happening on the bridge while they're watching it. Oh, didn't we tell you we've invited 120 people to come and watch? Do you think you could do that? Well, we did it. We installed a box with an entirely independent internet access and fed the information from the logger to that in such a way that it was independent. In other words, we absolutely knew that the guy driving the jacks was going to continue to have the information, and we bled off what we could to feed the public. But it also provided us with the advantage, by having that big aerial on top, of providing them all with an internet connection so they could stand there in the tent watching it go up and tweet about it, and they did. And here's a view of the monitoring. What can we see? So this is essentially the view that was provided for the driver. So the big square here is simply saying this is where the bridge has got to now. To the left of it is a time plot. So the left-hand column is time, the right-hand column is it? No, it isn't. Sorry. Yes, it is time. The right-hand column is positioned in more than one direction, typically. So this is just showing how far we've got to. This is showing how we've got there, and you can see it goes up. It's held while the blocks are put in. It goes down 20 millimetres onto the blocks, and then there's a pause while everybody thinks about it before it goes up again. So that trace is fairly clear. The next row shows us how the span is changing at the two sides. And if you look at it carefully, you'll notice it's going in opposite directions. So one side is increasing in span slightly, the other side is reducing in span slightly. And we might expect that to have an effect, and it does indeed have an effect. It causes the bridge to twist as it goes up. It only twisted about 5 millimetres. Wasn't a particular worry, but it's nice to know that we could do it, and it's nice to know that we could watch it, and that we could make rational decisions about whether it was going in the right direction or not. And that's really there just as an indication of the sort of things we can do these days when it comes to monitoring on site. And now a few pictures showing what the bridge is really like. Here's a view through the wing wall, which, as you can see, is superbly constructed. Absolutely stunning quality brickwork with barely any mortar in sight. That's the underside of the cut face, which actually is quite clogged with mud, so you can't really see terribly well what's going on there. But if we look downwards, you can see that there is no mortar in the perpend joints of those bricks. You can see that they're lined up pretty well across the width of the bridge, and they're also lined up front to back. So if it wants to crack, there really is nothing to dissuade it from doing so. And we rather suspect the bricks might be stacked vertically as well. So absolutely nothing to stop it cracking. But it's also interesting to see that, you know, there's a non-trivial span there. Now, this bridge is 4 metres wide, just over 4 metres wide, so there's about a metre and a half between that jack and this jack. It's perfectly happy. It's not terribly well built, but the mortar is actually quite capable of holding sort of this height of brickwork. One wouldn't wish to stand underneath it, but for a job like this, it's fine. Just lift it. It'll be okay. Here in the wing wall, we can see another reskinning job going on where there's a joint right through there that isn't connected at all. I think we've seen that before, haven't we? A bridge up in the air. Slightly closer look at the jack, and people with their fingers further in than I would really wish, and the ecky timbers, which when at their full height squashed about a millimetre with 100 tonnes on top of them, which is not really a lot, is it? Incidentally, the jacks, there were 10 jacks, 5 in each abutment, and they were all connected to a computer control system which controlled each jack independently. So we knew how much pressure there was on each one, and we were able to tweak them to either balance the pressure or balance the movement as required. Although in the end, nobody could decide which to go for, so we tended to just let it go. And it worked. It was okay. There again, the soldiers up the side to hold the parapets in, and a fairly tall pile of timber, but obviously fairly stable. Although it would make an interesting game of Jenga, wouldn't it? Just there you can see the underside of the cut face. And, yeah, well, what can I say? A few more bits of details of pictures. And mostly it's stuff that you've either seen before or... Well, let's have a look at this crack, shall we? It's getting on for 2 inches, yeah, maybe 40 millimetres wide at the back of the abutment, which is quite a lot. There was no sign of the wing wall being 40 millimetres further apart than it should be. But then if you reskin the wing wall and plumb it, you could probably disguise that fairly effectively. And again, oh... Why keep doing it? You can see in the right-hand picture that the crack wanders away up into the arch as well. It doesn't actually go as far as our concrete over the top. We did try to fill it because we wanted to squeeze the abutment a bit just to make sure it really did stay together. Bear in mind, of course, it's 4 metres wide, but there's 2.5 metres of brickwork this way between where the jacks are and the top face. So it's quite a chunky piece of material. The stresses are very low. There's no real worries about it breaking up, except where it's been broken through already, and then that might be some difficulty. That looks a little bit out of place, doesn't it? That's just preparatory cores, and we seem to have got them really quite badly out of order. I'm sorry. Preparation. This was the one I was coming to. This was the point that really blew my mind when we got the thing right up and everybody was set to go home for the day. And I walked round the back of the abutment and looked down there, and there is this 900 millimetre gap that you could practically walk through in this arch bridge. And of course, up here, you're seeing the core slots. Right, so the wing wall, the step in the wing wall that goes through at this level is now up here. Quite a spectacular change. We've already looked at that several times, but it never fails to intrigue me, the fact that people thought they could get away with it. Well, of course they could get away with it. They did get away with it. They got away with it everywhere they built these bridges. And it pays, first of all, to remember that that's how they're done, and therefore they're pretty ropey. But secondly, to remember that it doesn't actually matter, because these things get their strength and their stiffness from the area, not from the strength of the material. They're big, there's lots of space for the force to go, so you don't need a lot of strength. There are times during the construction when you might need bits of strength in particular places, but once it's finished and in use, it's fine. There we are, one bridge 900 millimetres higher than it used to be. A slightly optimistic view of costs, I think, but bridge reconstruction is certainly 2 weekends and is typically three-quarters to £1 million. Track lowering is £1.5 to £2 million. We reckon we can do ElevArch for half to three-quarters, which is kind of close.
But actually, I think we can save quite a lot off that. We can certainly reduce the time. We can reduce the amount of invasive work. We can increase the reliability. We can dramatically reduce the amount of reinforcement used, so we can make it a much cheaper and quicker process. And I just want to say that demolition is just so 20th century. Why do it? Why not just lift it? Okay?
Thanks very much, Bill. It's great to see that you're reinventing yourself and you've got a whole other career to look forward to.
Yeah.
In bridge lifts. But no, it was really interesting, and just want to open it to the floor for any questions. Again, if you could just give your name and who you work for, it'd be great.
Yep.
Thank you, Bill. Very interesting talk. John McGowan here. Could you describe how, in actual fact, you would fill the gap, when you have actually completed the lift? What remedial work was needed to make it a functioning path on the top of the bridge, etc.?
Somehow or another, I lost the slide. There is a picture, which I thought I'd put in, of the bridge when it's finished. So all the brickwork was patched with second-hand, old-fashioned imperial bricks, and certainly a friend who couldn't get to the actual lift went up to have a look and said he couldn't see where we'd lifted it. So one of the things that I said fairly early on was, they said, well, we want it lifted 500 millimetres or 400 millimetres, and I said, no, we're going to lift it 435. Why? Because that's an exact number of courses, and then when we stitch the sides together, it'll stitch, won't it? Why make life difficult? And it worked fairly well, except that the beds of brickwork, as you go up from springing level in the wing walls, they do that until they get to the slope of the parapet. And obviously that was done just by judgment, largely. So the four corners are all slightly different. So we got, I think, three corners were fairly well stitched, but the fourth corner was about a third of a brick out. So far as the joints were concerned. But yes, we the hole was filled with concrete, but so the bridge was set on mortar bags, which were put into pieces of plastic drain pipe because the mortar bags just wouldn't stand the half metre height. So that was filled until the weight was taken, we could take the jacks out, then a single skin brick wall built around the edge in traditional bricks, which look very much the same as the ones that are there, and then the whole thing flooded with concrete. Again, if we were going to be doing this on live railway, I would be looking to have ready-made panels to lift in, so they could be lifted in overnight and just put the bridge down onto them, nip them, and then flood with concrete behind.
Ian McGahey, I'm wondering, how did you restrain the thrust? I wasn't clear on that. I could see you drilled holes, but I couldn't see how the lateral thrust was restrained.
So we put a bearing in each corner against the wing wall. So we drilled those holes up the side, just two steel plates with a slight gap, piece of PTFE in the gap, and filled behind them with mortar. And then it just slid vertically up the gap.
And while the holes were drilled, were you not concerned about?
No. There was nothing to make it go. No, I mean, the holes were drilled not right through. So once the bearings were in place, then we sawed the slot above and below to release the compression. So the trick is to make sure there's always somewhere for the force to go.
Yeah.
So the bearings went in first, and then we cut the bricks for the rest of the way. So there was always a place for the force to go. We did, incidentally, have a couple of ties in so that if the wing walls sheared off, we were pretty sure they weren't going to, but there were people who weren't so sure and felt we needed the belt and braces.
You couldn't do that in the real situation.
You couldn't do that in the real situation.
But one thing that I'm looking at a slightly different jacking scheme, because with a wider bridge, you couldn't just put the sliding on the wing walls. You'd need to put bearings across the width. And you'd also need to distribute the jacking better. When that fancy jacking system was bought, we hadn't realized just how badly cracked the bridge was. And there were obvious worries about distribution of load between those jacks when it came to the crunch. Again, if you were doing a 10-meter wide bridge, you would have to distribute the load more seriously. So we're trying to look at ways which might allow us to put a bearing effectively at the jacking point and a tie across above train level. So you held it in two places rather than just one.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you do that, then you can do it on the skew as well. Yeah.
Sorry, what was the capacity of each jack?
I think they were 100 tonners. So we had 500 tons available in each abutment and about 200 tons actually sitting there. I think that's right. Yeah.
The stroke at the jack was at least 100.
And the stroke at the jack was about 150, so we could lift it to 140 comfortably, put in the piece of timber and drop it the 20 millimetres onto there. And the actual lift, that 120 millimetre lift, took perhaps 2 or 3 minutes. The time was in putting the timbers in, setting it down, and then once it was stable, going round and examining everything before we lifted any further. Because this time everybody wanted to know, you know, that everything was...
Could you tell the weight of the lift from the jack pressure?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
What did it come out to be?
It was within about 10% of what we'd said. I wouldn't like to say any better than that. Yeah, but it was within 10%, which is really as good as you're going to get with materials like this. You've no idea how much air there is in there, have you? Well, you have when you've seen. but you don't know what the bricks are like inside. Well, again, you sort of do. Right? It took me quite a long time to realise that in the 19th century, a bricklayer's labourer was a semi-skilled person. Because what he got delivered to him was a random pile of bricks. And he had to sort the ones that could go on the outside, which would stand the weathering, from the ones that needed to go on the inside because they were rubbish, and had to deliver what the bricklayer needed. Now, he didn't get it perfect, as you could see from all the badly eroded bricks in that wing wall. Is that visible somewhere? No, it isn't really, is it? But it was a semi-skilled job, and you can be confident that the construction quality is worse where you can't see it, and that the materials are worse when you can't see them. How much worse depends on the job, but you can be absolutely confident that both will be worse, yes.
Have you tried a cut stone arch?
No. No, we've done one. It's a start, and now people are prepared to say, okay, maybe it can be done. No, surely it will just break up. They're brittle. No, they are not brittle. And I can take you to arches which have twisted 200 millimetres in that span, and not a sign of a crack in them. Yeah? It's fine. Yeah, okay. What do you want to do?
Will you ever attempt a skew arch?
If I was given one to try, I wouldn't have any qualms about it at all. Well, you know pretty much where the forces go, right? And there's a myth about skew arches that the thrust tries to concentrate in the corners, in the obtuse corners. It's a myth. It's based on extrapolation from the understanding of the way slabs work. Now, when we analyse a slab, we treat the abutments as rigid. And to all intents and purposes, they are. Right? They are so stiff in this sense, and the slab is so flexible in that sense, that there is 2 or 3 orders of magnitude difference in stiffness, and we can treat the abutments as rigid. In this direction, the arch is much stiffer than the soil behind the abutment. the situation is completely reversed. So if you try to concentrate load in the obtuse corners, the abutments just lean back a bit. They only have to go a quarter of a millimeter and the stress is gone. And I was finally convinced of that when I dived under a bridge in Exeter 15 years ago, 16 years ago, and found a three-span skew arch bridge standing on two piers, and each of the piers was four granite columns. Those granite columns have no torsional stiffness in plan whatsoever. Therefore, the thrust in those skew spans couldn't be offset. Had to be in the middle. If it's in the middle, then it has to be on the skew. Think about the engineering. Yes,
did,
sorry.
Did you consider at any stage putting in a tie in case?
There were ties in there which were capable of carrying the load if it broke, but they would have deflected probably 50 or 60 millimetres before they... So there'd have been a crack in the arch. It wouldn't have fallen down, but there would have been a crack in it.
A tie across the span?
Tie across the span.
Within the deck somewhere?
It was down at springing level. So it would have been in the way of the railway, but there was all sorts of stuff that would have been in the way.
Was that the black carbon
fibre? Well, there were two things. There was a carbon fibre pole, which was used to measure the deflection, and more or less alongside it, there was a tie bar. But it was only a sort of 20 millimetre tie bar, which had plenty of capacity to carry the load, but it would have stretched about 50 millimetres. So it was stressed to about 14 millimetres, I think, but would have had to go another 35 before it stopped the thing moving. How are we doing?
Okay, we might have time for one more question if there's anyone got a burning question they want to ask Bill. Yep.
Have you done an estimate on the number of bridges that may require to be raised or demolished or etc.?
Network Rail are busy electrifying railways. At the moment, we're looking at a couple more on this line, and three on the line from Oxenholme to Windermere. But there are other lines which are yet to be electrified. The picture is that there's probably a minimum of 50 in the next few years that would sensibly be lifted rather than replaced. There are obviously other issues, like the fact that if you lift it, you end up with the same thickness at the crown. So you've then got to lift the deck. And there's also the issue of moving services and things like that. This bridge had no services on it. There was an electric cable, but it was dead, so they just came and spiked it and we cut it out. So there's obviously services to be dealt with. But we're pretty confident that we can match on cost once we start going seriously for cost. Yes.
Bill, Aidan Farrell from Kildare National Roads Office. Given that there was, not an insignificant amount of additional loading on the foundations, was any strengthening required?
No, we checked it all out and it was fine. There was plenty of capacity. The big loading, the only increased loading was that the thrust was moved higher. Yeah, so it had to be contained, and we were able to show satisfactorily that it could be contained with the wing walls and the fill behind the wall. As it happens in the end, because the site had to be cleared because the badgers next door were about to start breeding, the abutment was filled with concrete. And that's going to be fun when they come to demolish the bridge and take it away, isn't it? But
just one final question then. And as you're probably aware, I suppose the number of brick masonry arches in Ireland are few and far between. Yeah. It's mainly random rubble, ashlar stone, whatever. Mm. Following on from what Eamon was talking about there, is it potentially a step too far to be able to hope to apply something like that to our masonry arch bridges, in particular sort of the ashlar cut stone bridges?
My original thought was about the bridges that were listed on the Great Western when they were electrifying that. Now, as it happens, they got the listing removed and demolished them, which is kind of tragic, I think. With appropriate care, you can choose where you cut. Even an ashlar bridge, you know, an ashlar bridge often will have details like pilasters and things like that. You can cut alongside a pilaster and disguise the cut. I think it can be done. If you have a bridge that is an absolute treasure, really an absolute treasure, then I see no fundamental difficulty with lifting it from ground level. Yeah, just lifting the whole thing. It's just a bit more weight. It isn't a big weight in modern terms. We think, gosh, these things are huge, but they aren't. You know, we think nothing of slinging 1,000 tons from a crane and putting it in place. And there aren't many masonry bridges that weigh more than 1,000 tons. Sitting them on jacks and lifting them isn't really that hard. It's just a matter of getting your head around the idea that it's okay. Right, I think we better let the last person go, had we? I'll be around because I can't get home. I couldn't get a plane home tonight.
Thanks very much, Bill. It's been a real pleasure having you here today. So.
So our fourth presentation today is on the structural design and construction of the Dublin Waste to Energy facility, and it's been presented by John Diffley, Senior Structural Engineer of PM Group, and also by Diarmuid O'Sullivan, Senior Construction Manager of PM Group. John Diffley is the lead structural engineer for the project. Was the lead structural engineer for the project, and he'll discuss some of the structural design challenges presented during the building of the facility, including foundation solutions, steelwork design, fatigue design for the crane girders, concrete design, and how the design evolved and developed to meet the project requirements. Diarmuid O'Sullivan was the construction manager for the project, and he'll discuss the construction challenges the project presented, including the restrictions of the brownfield site, managing the schedule, and health and safety management. Diarmuid will talk about the construction management team, how the construction management team worked to overcome these challenges and build a landmark facility. Thanks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Seeing that I have the graveyard shift, I hope I can keep you all awake and alive and listen to our presentation. I have to commend it to Bill. That was a very good presentation, very interesting, and hopefully we can keep some of the interest going this afternoon in this discussion. I'll start off effectively with introductions. I've already been given my Emmett. My name is John Diffley. Was the lead structural engineer on the project for the Dublin Waste Energy. As you can see, my hair has got a little bit greyer since. My co-presenter is Diarmuid O'Sullivan, and when he comes up here, you'll see his hair has got a little bit greyer too. So, we're going to talk to you today effectively, but I'll give you a brief introduction to the project, what Dublin Waste Energy actually is, how it, the actual key facts of the project, how the actual whole process system works within the building, what it's actually achieving, and then I start going into discussions with regard to some of the design challenges we faced and how we overcome them, and then Jeremy will discuss some of the issues in regard to the construction of it. First of all, I'll just give you, for people who don't know who PM Group are, we're an Irish-owned company, 100% employee-owned. Some of the key facts there, over 2,200 people employed worldwide. 17 offices worldwide, operating in about 30 countries, 44 years in business, so it gives people a flavour of what PM Group is about. To give you an overall project view, I suppose this will be an early stage photograph of some of the steel framing on the project, but it gives a perspective of some of the sizing of it. But the key facts to the actual project, it's a PPP project between Covanta and Dublin City Council on behalf of the four councils. The facility will divert up to 600,000 tonnes per year of waste from landfill. The energy recovery as part of this process is classified as the energy from waste is classified as energy recovery by the EU. And the project, as of course, is located in Poolbeggy for people who aren't familiar with it, although it has got lots of attention, so I assume a lot of people in the room will be familiar where it is. Other statistics about the job, It will export electricity to power of approximately 80,000 homes to the national grid. It has the capability also to provide district heating to about 50,000 housing units within the region. The actual infrastructure within the facility is in place for that, and it is an option for Dublin City Council to take that option up and produce the district heating to the areas. There's about 1,200 jobs, or 1,200 maximum people on site during the construction peak. I think at the moment we're running around 900. There'll be about 100 jobs during the operation of the facility, through maintenance, operations, just general management of the facility. And the investment is approximately 500 million, so it's a substantial infrastructure project for the country, and the investment is not small. For the site, that's the site there. That's what it looked like in September 2014. There had been some preparatory works done at an earlier stage back in 2009-2010, but the project had stalled at that stage due to some legal challenges, but it has proceeded since. So I'll hopefully give you this presentation will give you an understanding of how we got from there to what you'd see at the end. Okay. To give people an understanding of the size, I suppose it's a building we're all familiar with. We'll have success in there on Friday night. Lansdowne Road gives you the perspective. She's slightly higher than it. She's slightly longer in the long direction, but I think you could effectively fit three football, full-size soccer pitches inside the Dublin Waste Energy facility. It won't stand out as much as Lansdowne Road does, but in the environment, for the simple reason of its location. But it's a more of an isolated building, so it doesn't stand out to be as significantly large as that image shows you. This is a very early slide on the execution strategy. Effectively tells you up there, Covanta and Dublin City Council, it's part of the PPP contract holders. PM were engaged to do the engineering, procurement, and construction management of the term of the civil works. And you have Hitachi, Ozan, Innova, they're a Swiss-based company, or HZI as they're more commonly known. They were the EPC contractor for the process system. So on the left-hand side there, you will see some of the scope of works that PM would have done. Now, this is from an earlier slide. There has been lots of other contractors and multiple packages extended onto that. The likes of Yeoman there at the front, I better get a mention. Banner would have had a part to play in this project as well, and stuff like that as well. So there is lots of other contractors involved in the construction of it, not just the ones you see on the screen. To give you people an understanding of how the actual facility works, this is effectively a schematic process diagram of the actual of how the system works. Waste enters the building. It's stored in a large bunker, concrete bunker. From here, you have large gantry cranes, mixes the waste, picks it up, drops it through a feed hopper into a furnace, and then onto the boiler systems. Then it goes down through here, the exhaust, into what they call the flue gas treatment area, which goes through a reactor system here, where there's some chemicals and lime added to the actual exhaust to clean them out. And then there's a bag filter system here that actually reduces the actual ashes. And then it is exhausted out through large ID fans, which is pushed, which is sucks the air through the whole process and out through the stack. At the bottom of the furnace grate, they take away what they call the bottom ash. And I suppose the best way to describe this is it's no different than a fireplace in your house. You have the bottom ash that comes out, that you take your ash out in the morning, and then you have what they call the fly ash that goes up into your chimney. With this type of system, your bottom ash goes out here, stored in an ash bunker, and then it's discharged. I think it's a monthly that are removed from the facility for further refining. And this filter system here effectively takes what you find in your chimney, your soot, the nasty stuff. That's handled in an enclosed system, and that's also taken off site in control measures. The steam that the boiler produces drives the actual steam turbine, which in turn drives the generator and produces electricity, which exports it to the grid. The steam, the turbines and generators are water cooled, so there's a water extraction facility on the Liffey, which takes the actual water in and sends the water back. And the whole steam system, the whole process system is effectively water cooled. Part of that steam system diverts the actual district heating into the provisions that is in the plant. Okay, so that gives people an overview of how the actual systems work. Some of the design challenges we came across on this, I suppose this like every project, there is challenges. This one, is it any different to any other project? Probably not. The only maybe it might be the scale of the problems was significant. So we had different ones. There was complex interfaces on it, and there was multidisciplinary input. The project team in this was based in Ireland, Switzerland, Germany, Czech Republic, Holland, England, New Jersey, Spain, you name it, Poland, everywhere. So it wasn't just, you know, one or two people or one or two companies coming together. It was the actual integration of all those companies, nationalities, engineering, which was a significant task. Schedule was probably, from a design side of things and from a construction side of things, from PM group scope was very challenging. There was a 33-month schedule. Effectively, we got notice to proceed on the construction on the 19th September 2014, the same day we got notice to start the detailed design. I think that was on a Friday. The following Monday, there was a piling rig driving piles on site. So it wasn't the case that we actually had time to actually to sit back, tease it out, design, and move on. We had to hit the ground moving on it. The team, as I said, it was a very globally diverse team. Although engineering is based on maths, there is a culture and diversity we have to take into account. But you convey to somebody in Poland or in Spain or in the Czech Republic or in Switzerland, not everybody reads the emails the same way, guys. I can tell you that. You know, and the understanding everybody takes out of conference calls isn't the same understanding. And that was a key fact, key issue, you know.
That's just between the Irish team.
Yeah, that's the Irish team, you know. And of course, the interface management, there was a lot of interfaces. I know myself, I would have been probably having an interface with everything in the project. Or sometimes you'll often get these heavily processed jobs, the structural engineer would have interface with maybe 60-70% of it, where we would have an interface with nearly everybody in this type of project. And the scope definition was definitely had to be defined very early and managed and controlled. So those some of the technical challenges. The first one we looked at is the foundations. Just give you an idea what we had to think about this and considering what we were saying. We started to design the same day we started to build. If we'd done a traditional foundation approach, we all look at that there, you would have, forgot to say, all this building is piled due to the nature of the site. So we've had to come along, pile it, cut the piles off, trim them, then come along, lean mix them, place your rebar, your shutters, pour your pile cap, put your backfill in, etc., etc. Now, when you see the size and you see the plan, the aerial shots of this, you'll see the amount of columns and loadings that would be on this. The amount of individual foundations in this job, we'd probably still be building foundations at this stage if we stuck with the traditional foundation approach. So what we had to do on the project, we had to come together as a whole project team, not just us as structural engineers and construction managers on the job and say, look, this is the way we're going to do it, because we had to think, we had 9 months to produce nearly to have 80% of the foundations of this building designed and built, given the size of that project. So we got together with HZI, the construction manager, and his client, and agreed the best forward solution. And the actual solution on the project, given the size of the building, was a large pile mat. In order to achieve this, we needed help from the process contractor. So what they issued was what they called not to exceed load data. That gave us all the heavy column loads, anything ranging from 1,000 kilonewtons up to 6,500 kilonewton column loads. They also gave us a universally applied area load and the construction loads. So when we had these rafts built, they could come along, and if they were moving equipment in the last phase of the design, they could put 100 kilonewton point loads anywhere on that project, anywhere on the raft foundations. given this information, that allowed us to design a pylon, the pylon based on a symmetrical grid, and also the raft slabs. Given that, PM Group handed over a substantially complete boiler and FGT areas to HZI and Schedule. We're the first civil contractor never to hold HZI up on these projects. And they have, I think, 485 reference projects worldwide. To give you an idea of what the actual foundation systems would have been like during the construction, it's an aerial shot of the actual raft slabs during the construction. You can see here on the south side of the building, you've actually cranes on it straight away. You've the raft pours in progress. As you can see, it wasn't groups of individual pile foundations with all the associated backfills and controls methods on it. The benefit of it, the construction benefit was huge on this, and Jeremy will go on to further later to go to the constrictions we had on the site. People look and say, oh, you have loads of space there. When you see the crane statistics into this job, you'll see, my God, we didn't have a lot of space on it. When those rafts were poured and handed over, HZI could come along and they put in multiple cranes. All their laydown area was on the footprint of the building. It wasn't from the outside. So you can think we can count 1, 2, 3 cranes there at the moment. And probably 2 days later, there could have been another 2 or 3 cranes on that. And that allowed them to build 6,500 tonne of structural steel to support the boiler systems early. And they could build it from the inside out rather than the outside in. Okay. The pylon on the project, give people all the structures were CFA piled. The site is effectively a reclaimed site. I think we have some old maps that doesn't even show actually land there, you know. But we had 5 meters of variable fill on the original sands and gravels, and that fill contained everything. Things that you never thought you'd ever find on the building site, we found it. I think the only thing that wasn't found on it was bones, probably, luckily enough. I think, I know at one stage there was an option in one area of the building to put in stone columns under a fill material, and one of the contractors from the UK came over to do some of the stone column trial digs, and I think within the first one, he took out 7 Pirelli tyres. So we found everything on it. And the pylon was designed to Euro codes, and it was based on a combination of skin friction and end bearing. And so the pylon works was carried out by Lowry's. I think there was 4,500 piles on the project, or close to that. The concrete works, I think that picture kind of tells a story, the sheer size and the scale of it. I know we heard in earlier presentations about GGBS mixes and all that. The bottom 7 meters of that has 70% GGBS in the mix. Above that is 50% GGBS. And there's no doubt about it, but they said earlier as regards the actual how that ages over time and the colour changes it does. It actually will end up white if you don't put waste in it. So as regards that, the waste bunker dimensions, 75 metres by 25 metres wide by 25.5 metres high. That bunker itself, that was designed for the vertical and lateral waste load and is water retaining for the bottom 7 metres. Is also some of the walls here, this wall here is actually below the tipping gates, is actually tanked, and the wall behind the photograph is tanked. The other wall, the back wall, and that back wall is actually open to the process areas. Some of the wall thicknesses are 1 meter. The reinforcement is 32s of 150, both faces each way, and shear length. So there's quite a lot in it, but you have to appreciate some of these walls are spanning 30 metres by, and the vertical span is 25.5, and they are taking a substantial design load. The ash bunker, which is an adjacent bunker to store the actual bottom ash, is 40 metres by 15 metres by 17 metres high, so no small concrete box either, and that again is designed for the vertical and lateral load from the stored ash. It's a stair core in it, it's 45 metres high with precast flights and landing supported by steel billets. And the method of construction of those three items was slip forming, for the simple reason we wouldn't have actually achieved the target dates on the construction with trying to do any other jump forming or any other type of system. So that gives you a picture of the actual waste bunker. I think the last northern wall has just been topped out there with slip forming, and the eastern wall, that's the I think it's 45 metres high stair core. I think it was 7 or 8 days that was constructed. 7 days that was constructed, start to finish, slip forming. And, sorry, let's go back here.
and that one there, that's the ash bunker where it had just started, probably a couple of days old. Okay. Again, you can see the benefit of having the rafts. You have a couple of cranes positioned on the site already. To achieve this, there was extensive trial mixes and testing had to be done by Quick and Kilsarran to ensure we actually met the specification. Not alone is 70% GGBS an issue with traditional pours. When you try and do a slip form, and it takes a lot of effort, and there was a lot of effort put into Kilsarran and Quick to make sure we got it right. The reinforcement was detailed soup slip forming, the maximum bar length of 6 meters. And of course, the Euro codes. The lap lengths proved challenging because the slip forming is considered as providing poor bond condition. So I think when we had 32 mil bars, the lapping was a challenge. So the answer to it effectively was that we ended up all vertical splices had to be used threaded bars. There was no option, because if you were trying to do your traditional laps, the claps were clashing with the laps. So it just didn't work. It also sped up the actual speed of placing in the slip forming, considering the pace this was lifted at. That's what happened. We did have a few issues at the start of the slip forming on the waste bunker. It was actually done in shift. It was actually day pour, stop, day pour. It was starting to cause a bit of dragging in some areas because it was catching in corners. The actual concrete was hardening overnight in the corners of the slip forming rig, so it'll catch. But once we went to 24-hour shift, those problems abated. So this gives you an idea. This is where we started in March 2015 on the slip form, and you can see it there, the slip form of the waste bunker. That's the actual, the slab hadn't even been poured to the ash bunker at the time, and the stair core 4 was probably instilled in somebody's imagination or in some drawing we were looking at. April, you have the south and the western wall of the waste bunker halfway up. The foundation of the ash bunker is there. May, you can start the actual, we had the north and the eastern wall of the waste bunker was up. And then by the middle of June, although the photograph states the 1st of July, but the actual slip form and rigs have been disassembled from all those and demounted. So effectively from March to the middle of June, that was actually achieved, that volume of concrete pouring. Steelwork framing, to move on from the concrete. We had three separately braced buildings. That's a typical section through the actual federated model of the building. So we had three buildings split by movement joints. We had one building effectively was a tipping hall, waste bunker, administration, district heating area. Second building was the ash hall, the boiler hall, and the turbine area. And that area was integrated with the HZI steel framing, which was a challenge. And then we had what's called the flue gas treatment and product storage area building. So effectively three separate steel structures. And that's the actual, the real life picture when the red outline shows you where the actual the movement joints are. Some of the challenges. And every time somebody says to me, what type of buildings you like, this is a lovely rectangular buildings with straight vertical walls. Plumb lines are great. Try and do it with a building with 13 degree slopes, and all external walls are 13 degree slopes. I think the only straight walls we have in the building are internal walls. And again, corners. All corners are cone shaped, every one of them. No square corners, unfortunately. So that proved a significant challenge to geometry, and not alone from us, from a steel design and an erection and a fabrication point of view with Severfield, who were fantastic on the project, even from a cladding perspective. You can imagine every one of those panels were individually sized, cut, and it's the trying to figure that out was no easy task. You have large span roofs up to 37 meter clear spans. You have large span vertical slope trusses at 13 degrees. Gantry crane supports 38 metres above grade level, which is the flexion issue alone. We fatigue design for all cranes and steel supports due to the actual cycle numbers of the cranes as an operation. These cranes operate 24/7. And we have interface with the boiler structure, which was had a differential stiffness to the actual large envelope we were providing. All the analysis we would have carried out generally was carried out in robot. We found actually some of the other
steel design packages that we were traditionally used actually had limitations as regards checking second order effects and stuff like that, but a robot definitely suited what we needed to do on this job. To go into the three different individual buildings, simplified section of the tip and hollow waste structure, looks simple, far from it. So you have a 37 metre span roof truss onto a lovely sloping truss column, and then you have the other support column there. The waste bunker steel is support 25 metre or 24 metres. It commences here and there. The northern elevation of the waste bunker consists of a 28 metre high vertical trusses spanning 30 metres, commencing 24 metres above grade. The southern elevation consists of inclined vertical trusses as the section shows. Southern facade is significant to subjects of significant wind load. The northern elevation is an internal wall, so there isn't. People say, oh, well, what's the big issue about that? Deflection controls. We have crane rail there and a crane rail there. That's subject to substantial wind loading. That isn't. The allowable differential deflection between those two rails under any loading, including crane, wind, snow, you name it, combined, was 10 millimetres. And that was a significant challenge. Effectively, you had to try and make each structure rigid enough that there was no differential deflections. And of course, the crane support steelwork was subject to high fatigue loading. The issues we have with that would be that if it's subject to fatigue loading, you're into execution class 3 structures, et cetera, et cetera. It did pose a challenge. I think historically in Europe and in England, there has been significant issues when they actually tried this type of system before. They actually tried to support the crane off the building structure, which was an issue. The reasoning for having no columns coming down here is because the process system has to tuck in underneath this slab. The diagram I showed you, actually, the process diagram of the building earlier, showed where the waste came in here. It actually drops through an opening in that floor and down through the system. So it wouldn't permit columns there. That gives you a model shot of the actual northern elevation of that section of the building. And you can see from there, your trusses start here, spanning 30 metres. Okay. That gives you an idea of why the walls are a metre thick as well. You have a 30 metre span of the walls, I think 28 metres high of a span as well. Okay. Next slide. All right, move on to the actual crane girder supports. You know, the last slide showed that, and 3D is wonderful, and all our lovely new BIM products is wonderful. Fundamentally, lads, sometimes you have to come back to a pen and a piece of paper, or a pencil and a piece of paper, you know, to tease things out. We looked at this, and we knew if we didn't try and isolate the crane loads from the building structure, we were going to have significant problems, and there is case history of problems in the UK on this. So when we came up with a solution where we actually designed separate trusses to support the cranes running parallel to the main building frame. That's an indication of the separate truss. If we had to try and put the traditional bracket here, cantilever bracket off, and bring the crane loads down through that column, the elevation I showed you earlier, but all the full, that would have been all subject to fatigue loading and execution class 3 steelwork, which is that's cost. The introduction of that truss is that it limited the amount of that. Limited the amount of steel connection subject to fatigue loading. The crane support trusses were designed for a maximum 60% utilisation under ultimate load to accommodate the fatigue connection design. The load reversal stresses in the two cranes in operation had to be considered. Effectively, you have a warring truss spanning there and you have two cranes operating side by side, running together. You have load reversal in all your joints. That was fundamental to the actual joint design. And the reason why, you can see the actual side. Typically they're spanning about 30 metres, they're 4.5 metres deep. Top booms are weigh 340 kg per metre and the diagonals typically weigh 160. There is in some areas the actual diagonals are heavier than that again. It's a fully welded truss. Reason why we had issues, we had to design that and put in such heavy sections. The actual, the weld strength was reduced by 75% due to the fatigue loading. Every one of those joints are butt welded ground flush, you know, and tested to the amount of testing on it is significant. Okay. And the support columns in this area here, they're 1600 millimeters deep. They're very substantial. That gives an indication as to why we would have had those issues. The image on the right, you can see the actual
in blue the actual isolated crane support structure, and then you have the building structure here. On the left-hand side there is your traditional way any building we ever see cranes are supported on. The crane girder sits on usually on a regularised grid and regularised columns. You have that stiff elevated frame controlling the lateral deflections here. You didn't have a lot there, so that was a significant challenge on it. So again, pretty picture, that's what it looks like in reality. You can see the actual crane support trusses here, supported on a large plate girder column, and then the elevational steelwork that supports the roof and everything else behind that. That's it, supporting the actual cranes in life. And the two green in there, that's the actual feed hoppers where the waste is brought from the bunker and discharged through the furnace system. The ash oil and the boiler hall steel design, to give you an idea, the shaded area there is actually the boiler structure. That's subject to substantial thermal stresses, loadings, it is the 6,500 tonne of steel by HZI. The building envelope is significantly, is a little bit less. So it is a large and stiff element where we had columns spanning, coming up 35, 40 metres. This one here is probably nearly close to 50 metres. Very flexible. So there was the challenge. There was significant challenges on that. The elevation controls, because the cladding systems and the architecture, the original scheme architect specification for deflection controls proved very challenging to meet that. Also in the ash hall, we also had crane supports. One crane thankfully was on the actual concrete wall, the other one was on steelwork, where we can control the amount of fatigue loading was on that. The flue gas treatment building. It's a 3D image of the actual with the Revit model on it. It's an independent frame. It was, we all thought, oh yeah, it's the simplest. We don't have a lot of integration with other contractors on it, but we have intersecting roof walls on a conical corner. That was another geometrical nightmare trying to figure that out. We have roof trusses span typically 30 metres, which span this way, and then you have a central line down the middle, which actually also has support trusses in that. The northern elevation supports curtain wall and with stringent deflection criteria. And you can see that the northern wall is at the one wall here with the actual inclined vertical trusses. And that's a 38 metre high inclined vertical trusses. So there was actually, that was a significant challenge as well to get the controls, and actually the erection and alignment of that was a challenge. The other area in design was an issue was actually the tipping hall. The tipping hall is 7 metres above the actual external grade level. It's accessed through a precast ramp onto the actual into the tipping hall. Because there was 5 metres of fill on the site, there was a lot of contamination issues. So there was actually the vision was to reuse as much of the excavated material as we could on site. So what you see there shaded is actually fill material, one from the site. The original intention was to have that on stone columns. Stone columns proved not to be technically feasible. So there was, I think, well into the stage, we were actually well on site, we actually realised that original design option or consideration had to be changed to piles. That's sitting on another raft slab, and then you have 7 metres of fill on it. So what you have is you have the existing ground was considered contaminated. It's approximately 15,000 cubic metres of excavated soil was used in the build-up of it. The external perimeters consisted of a reinforced earth retaining wall. Site one material was graded, we met the compaction used. Settlement was monitored for 9 months under construction, loading, and is less than 2 millimetres measured. And then the sub base and the ground floor was left to the last, actually after the building envelope was complete. And that's the benefit of it there. You can see the cranes erecting the tipping hall steelwork was actually up on that 7 metres of fill. How the actual design was done, collaborative tools. PM Group uses Revit, HZI used PDMS. It was compatibility issues, so that had to be set up early at the start. That was all integrated into a Navisworks model. There was also native exchanges between our Revit native files in set formats and also into the actual PDMS files, so we could actually coordinate in Revit, not just the Navisworks. The Navisworks produced the clash management tools and the 3D modeler views. So model image, real life. So it didn't work out too bad. That's a indication of the actual Revit, the civil structure and architectural model, showing the actual cladding detached. I keep saying, as the ruin the building, we're putting the cladding on it.
Hopefully there's no architects in the room. Look a lot better, I think, when the steel was exposed. And that's what it looks like in real life. So it's not too bad to go from there to there. We didn't do too bad. Okay, so I'm going to hand it over to my co-presenter, Diarmuid.
Thanks, John. Right, I won't keep you too long, right? And like I always say when I do, right, there's no problem so great that I can't make worse, all right? So when you get a call and you're somewhere in Central Europe on a project and you're saying, come over here, we want you, right? And I'm saying, can you send me any drones? No, when you start in 4 weeks' time, that's great. All right, so this is meant to be the whole life cycle approach of a project. Health and safety in the middle, everything else floats around the project scope, project execution, how you pull it together, project delivery, the whole lot. You expect to have engineering and drawings and specs in there originally to pull it all together? No, but it does come, right? You have to get into it at the very, very outset. I'm a structural engineer, construction manager by some divine intervention, I got shoehorned into it. But I'm in there, I'm able to engage with the structural engineers early. Right? That was a huge success on the project. Our engagement early with the guys in the office really helped us along. So at the moment, you know, PM Group is an EPCM contract. The Americans, when they come over, it's all design, build, lump sum. Give it all to one contractor and everything will be fantastic and we'll move in a couple of months' time. That doesn't happen. You need collaboration. You need contractors to work with you. You need engineers to work with you. You have to sit down and go through all the motions of this, right? And at some stage in the project, you will hit milestones. You won't hit every milestone. You won't hit every schedule, but you'll get there. But it needs input from every body on a project. Someone not pulling the weight on a project, you have a major problem. So what we done on the project, we split it all up. Enabling contract, piling contract, foundations contract, steel contract, slip form contract. We broke it up, it made it much harder, but we could get stuck into technically, right, to find all the details, find the issues, deal with them, and work with the contractors. We therefore put technical people on the site. We put chief engineers on the site that at the time were able to deal with the issues. It's no good having a chief engineer on the site that's an electrical, mechanical, or a process engineer when you're knee-high and shite in the ground, right? There's piling rigs all over the place and you have a problem. The right people in the right place dealing with the issues, because there are issues every day. Design is coming out, it's coming out fast, it's coming out fast track. You're screaming for it. You're pleading for it, for sketches. You normally don't start on site first day, right, without a drawing. But we did, because we had to get going. Procurement was important. Like I said, you have to break it down. Environmental management on the site. The site has a wonderful history. It's fantastic. Gone through the whole green aspect of it, it's come all the way back, it's gone whole through CPOs, it's everything. You have it. Everybody's looking at it. Right? And we're sent down there and said, way you go. It's contaminated to the hilt. The whole peninsula is contaminated. All Dublin's gas works are down there. You name it, it's down there. However, what was done very early in the project, an Article 11 license, which meant we were able to take up contaminated ground and we could work it. And we could deal with it. Huge amount of work done by Jacobs on this, years and years ago, to deal with this material. But dealing with it, right, when you have no room on the site to segregate it, test it, move it. It's the most well-moved material we have on the site. Use it, both from an environmental point of view, but also from a geotechnical point of view. They're so diverse apart. But when you bring them together and say, you have to use this material on this site, you promised. I said, that's fantastic. The best thing for us from a construction management point of view, send it off-site, get rid of the problem. No, we had to use it. Construction management up to construction completion. So we do the full raft. We set up the site, we run it, make everybody happy. That's 1,200 people in every day. Everybody's smiling to go home happy. Everybody's delighted. Fantastic. wonderful, come back. Parking, traffic, dust, water, sea, air, you name it, everything's a problem. But you have to keep it going, and you have to keep it moving. We also, the PSCS on the site, PSDP on the site, that brings huge issues. PSCS on site, fantastic. Construction manager on the site, yes, great. But you have another entity when you're looking at contracts, when you have a large process contractor who runs his own contractors on the site and has his own ways of doing things coming in from Europe is a problem. So you have all these issues, cultural, different languages, different barriers, different geographics, but you still have to build a project and you have to get over it and you have to move on. The schedule, mobilised start on site September 2014. Very important date. It's the last time Kerry won in All Ireland. I had to start on site Monday after in All Ireland. I wasn't very happy. Right? I haven't been happy since. Right? June 2015. We had to hit a date in June 2015. Process contractor had to start on site. We had to have the raft foundations poured and cured and ready to accept large columns, large cranage, while we were still walking around the site, and give them access to, so they could progress, so they wouldn't be held up, so we could get a jump on the project. That's where the rafts came in. We are bringing waste onto the site in the next couple of weeks. We've had our difficulties, we've had problems, but it's coming in. And for a power project to hit dates, right, I've worked on a few of them already, for it to hit significant dates, there must be something happening. There must be something right. There has to be something in there that's built in, right? And the target commissioning completion date, July, August, there, thereabouts. There's a reliability test to run somewhere in August, September. All right? So that's what's going into operation. So we've had all the waste contractors on site. They've been doing their walk around. The ramp is ready. It's ready to go. There's a lot of elements happening on it. So the main site, I'm not going to bore you because all the magic will happen later on, right? So the main site in itself, right? The main site, it is tight, and I'll explain why, right? To the left of us is the wastewater treatment works. To the right is a national oil reserve, right? To keep the power plants in that location going if something happens. To the right of us also, on Shellybanks Road, all the 220 and 110 kV lines are up and down it. To the back of us, there's a whole load of 110, 220. To the front of us, it's all 110, 220. We're a Faraday cage below there, right? That's the way it is. The cooling water is another significant project. Marine works, very important. The main sticking point of the Greens that time, right? We've a large, was carried out by BAM. Very critical, very important marine works. We built a whole intake station over there in the sea. It's not easy. A lot of difficulties. The main site thing, to bring in large equipment, the stuff has to come in from abroad. It has to come in early. It's not just in time delivery. These stuffs have to come in. They're large containers. We're taking in full shiploads of steel equipment, large boiler parts. Significant. They have to come in. They can't be stored in places. We store them on site. Compound, compacted, multi-story. Can't have a sprawling compound. Put everybody into the same compound. You have to think your way through. Car parking, nightmare. But when you're down there, right, and we give car parking, it solves a lot of issues. It solves a lot of issues. So this is the main site. You see, this main building takes up the bulk of it. So down here to the rear of the site, although it looks like a lot of space you can build, we couldn't put any cranes on it. Fantastic restraint to be right beside a 50 metre high building. The reason we can't put cranes on it, all the backbone coming from the turbines, further on down the gas turbines, come in along there to feed the city. They come up this road and they traverse up here as well. So you've got all this infrastructure, ESB have been with us solid, right, for months. Every trial hole we dug, every machine we pushed across it, they were there. They had to be there. This is their critical infrastructure for the city, for the hospitals, the back feeds. It all happens down there. There's 400 megawatt site up in Synergen. There's two further down beyond the chimneys. There's another one across the way. And for some reason, the whole thing flows around it. Footprint 20,000 square meters and footprint, gross floor area 32,000 square meters, 4,500 tons of structural steel. That's building envelope steel. It's all big, if you know what I mean. So you don't really, you know, you look at a couple of things and you just walk by them. Day one, you say, geez, that's big. Day two, you don't really care. Day three, it's up in the air, right? But it still has to come in. They take up a lot of space. They have to be there. 6,500 tons of process steelwork has to go in and get up in the air, right? The logistics of getting it through the city down to the port, because they're all fantastically designed, big trusses, they're all fantastic big columns. These things don't travel through the city that well. And most of them are under escort, right? Or it's out of hours. And we have to get them and get, be ready to drop them in. There's 4,250 of piles gone in there. I came back from Belgium, we had put in 5,000 piles and 5,000 mini piles, and I thought that's the last piling job now I'm doing for a while. Arrived down here and they said we were piling everything. Great concept, fantastic, right? But the amount of time and rigs that's to go in, the material that's coming up out of the sea, right, is high moisture content soil. That flows, right? You have four piling rigs on site. You've got this soup all over the place. You're trying to gather up, mix it, make it, dry it out, then try and transport it. You have to keep it on site. It's contaminated. We have to store it. We have to add lime to it sometimes. Keep going. You have to keep all this going. And then you're looking at it saying, we'll treat that now later. We'll put it in over here. But at that stage, you've taken up half the site. It takes up a lot of material, 4,500 piles, the amount of material, when you keep it on site. And you try and stockpile it, cover it, keep it going. At the moment, just where we are, we're still in the middle of construction. It's great for me to be here today because today isn't the day I usually get grilled on dates and milestones and all those wonderful things that go on a day to day. So at the moment, we've gone over 3,100,000 man hours at the moment on site. It's significant. We've been in a double shift process for the last 2 years. 24 hours. We work Saturdays, we work Sundays. We close for Christmas for a week for 2 years. That's it. We work straight through. At the moment, we've had about 5,000 people roll through the site. That's 5,000 people that you have to educate, bring up to speed, put through the system, go through the site rules, and try and get them home safely. That's a lot. But when you have them coming in from all different cultural areas, different projects, different zones, right? It takes a lot to put it together. You're putting people at serious heights, serious construction. There's no floors in there. It's all gantries, levels, all this. At the moment, we still have 100,000 cubes of scaffolding in the building. That's significant. At the moment, we had 1,200 at peak. We're still at 900. We still have 900 people working in around that facility. That's a large construction site to manage and control it. And we've about 20 different nationalities. For all these different nationalities, we need interpreters. We need English speakers to be able to interpret it, to be able to relate, to work with them, to help them, for them to talk to us is more important. So with 3 million man hours, right, we've had 7 LTIs on the site. Nothing significant. We'd have neck strains. That's a lost time incident. We've had banged heads. We've broken elbow. A couple of things like that. But we'd have no serious accident. We have a lot of minor things where thumbs, ankles, those type of things. And they must be recorded. Because you get these wonderful sites, 3 million man hours, 4 million man hours, no LTI. Rubbish. Absolute rubbish. You have to be true to yourself. You have to be true to people that are working there, and you have to deal with the difficulties that are on a site. And it's important because you're there to protect people. At the moment, say mobile cranes, we had mobile cranes everywhere. We were mobilizing mobile cranes day in, day out. They were going up because they have to lift big loads. The small tower cranes can't lift the loads that we were lifting. A 500 100-ton cranes on site, not an issue. 350-ton cranes, they were there every day. All the big craneage was there. It was good at the time because we were the large, big construction site at the time, and they were going. 25 mobile ton cranes a day, that's great, but you have to get around those, walk around them, and you have to bring material to them, and they have to go in. Tandem lifts, and you have to clear out the air, so you have to keep it all going, moving. Two of the largest cranes in Europe are sitting on the site. They're there for boiler lifts, drum lifts, large columns. 30 ton really at 60 meters, it's a big lift. It is a big lift. There's a lot of work to go into these. Now, I can talk about this forever. I'll get another crack at this some other day. But there's a video here that you should see, and it kind of speaks for itself, right? So we're almost there. I'll play the video for you if you can, and then we'll have questions and answers. Thank you.
Is it separate, is it?
Yeah.
So that's the top of the boiler. Boiler's top home expands downwards. Then the anchors pull out. There's the main FGT building, flue gas treatment.
Thanks very much, John Diarmuid, for taking up our graveyard shift. That was great, really iconic building, and it's fabulous to see it. Like, I really appreciate you coming in here, because like it's unusual for somebody to give a presentation when they're still in construction, and I can see how passionate you guys are, and you're still in the middle of it. So really appreciate you coming in, and maybe if you're finished by September this year, Kerry might get another crack at it, but we'll see. they drew with Dublin recently, so you never know. But look, we have to be out of here by six, but we do have time for a couple of quick questions. So I'll just open up to the floor, and you can just say your name. And yep.
I'm sorry, John. The other Porrick, is it?
Diarmuid,
I beg your pardon. I have a very short memory. John McGowan again. Fascinating project. As I was looking at your penultimate slide, the one where you had the stats,
yes.
In the background there were a number of coaster ships,
yes.
There. Were they part of the waste treatment process on site to deal with contamination, or where did you actually do whatever treatment you were doing? Was it being done there where the silo was shown?
No, what you actually see there is the that's right beside the Ecosem facility. So what you see is the Ecosem ships coming in, right, in the background. We had to keep all our waste on our footprint, on the main site. Our Article 11 did not allow us to move contaminated material off site, and if it did, it had to go to a facility, a recognised facility like Drogheda or something like that. So we could test everything. And if we were moving stuff off site, we had to state why, reasons for moving it, and where it was going. So no, we didn't move anything abroad. Everything was kept in Ireland, and the majority of it, we recycled it on site. Everything had to stay within the footprint of the building.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You are. Sorry about that.
A neighbour of your construction site and a Sandymount resident and supporter of the project. How did you engage with the local community, and what was the biggest political football of recent years? And what has been the positive engagement or negative engagement since the construction has started?
I suppose the biggest thing that we've done to date, right, is we went out to the community, and we probably at peak had about 50 people off the live register, right, taken in on the project. That's what we can do. Covanta and DCC and all that have a whole fund in the background, right, that they're supporting local projects and all that around the area. But from a construction point of view, right, is to bring as many people off the live register in, right, and hold on to them. Some of those people that came in are now being taken over into the Covant operations. So there is something happening there at the moment. But also what it does at the moment, we had huge pours in the project, and there was an issue around traffic and traffic management and stuff like that. We, at one stage, had a 2,500 cubic meter pour on that site, 320 odd lorries, but it didn't affect any of the traffic. You stagger it, you stage it, you plan it, you pull it from all various, you take all the batching plants in, from all the areas, you bring them in, they open up at different times, and you control it. It's both the control of material coming in into the site, the control of people. Providing parking in the area was a huge benefit, because you didn't have the problem with all this mad parking all over the place in people's houses, gardens, and stuff like that. So we were able to pull all the parking in there. We saw it as a benefit to the project, for the locality, so we didn't upset the neighbours. We may have upset yourselves once or twice, but we tried to keep it to a minimum.
Sure, look, we upset everybody every day, so.
Great. No, if not, we do have to be out of here by 6, so I'll just wrap it up. But I suppose the most, one of the things is we have certificates of attendance. So where you signed in at the table today, it should be there in alphabetical order. So you'd be able to pick that up and claim your 4-hour CBD. Just into a bit of advertising, our next half-day seminar is the 19th of October. And we'll probably have like three or four lectures at that again. And we probably have two booked in at the moment, which is the Claridge's, which I can't pronounce, hotel in London, and they're currently constructing a 5-story iceberg basement below it. So that'd be very interesting. And then also the Corrib onshore gas pipeline, which won the engineering project of the year and had 60 designers working on it since 1995. I suppose most importantly, just thanks to all our speakers today. It takes an awful lot of time and effort to put these presentations together, and we really appreciate it. So thanks very much to Bill, Jack, Yanis, Marcella, John, and Diarmuid. And I just want to close it now, and just if you could just show your appreciation in the usual manner. Thanks very much.